like King James.
Sounds like it is straight from the motherfucking cassette.
I hate when you get to a point in your career where people feel like they got you figured out and there's no more surprises. Mm. I like people to press play on my stuff and still be surprised. Whoa.
Cameras on, you'd love to see it. Welcome to this fucking Friday. Obviously, this fucking Friday starts, and as it happens, well, I mean, obviously, We're questionable today, okay? Listen, it's Friday. It's a relaxing day, but it's also not, because at the same time, we have two awesome guests that we're going to be on later today in the show. We have our boy Super on at 4:30 p.m. PST, and then also before then, we have Samito coming on at 4 p.m. PST. We'll interview him later, but there's also a couple important topics to go over before then, boys. Today, that we're going to rank the COD teams right now, COD League power rankings are this weekend, because of the fact that this weekend is COD League CDL's first tournaments, first matches happening this weekend. We'll go over that as well. There's a couple other tournaments that you need to be aware of for the weekend coming through, because guess what? Esports is starting to pick up, guys. Esports is starting to really get going. Esports is starting to be huge once again. The season is starting up. And because most of the time, obviously, because during the winter break area, during Christmas, during Hanukkah, during that whole era, basically November through January, it's pretty much break. It's break time. But now we're back. We're back full swing. And there's a couple things going on this weekend as well. There's also some big Twitch Rivals drama that happened, some more Warzone cheating. It seems like, honestly, we're talking about cheating this entire fucking week. Like, it just feels like every story has to do with cheats. And I don't know why. It's like I just saw a clip on Livestream Fails today with Soda Pop and dealing with the soldier cheating right now. Like, what is going on with cheaters, and why is it so prevalent? How do people keep doing it, and how do they keep getting away with it? When are more lawsuits going to come out where people are getting absolutely fucked financially because of cheats? I think that should happen. It could start up again. MMA also had something with pirating that I maybe can bring up as well later. Overwatch Nexus Cup is this weekend as well, guys. Oh, sorry, I'm moving on a little bit too quickly here, but there's some other stuff going on today. But yes, Nexus Cup is this weekend. We can talk about that, my predictions and stuff like that. Also, CSGO Blast Premiere is happening and is going on as well. And this weekend's also the Loser Bracket Finals and Finals as well, so we can cover that coming in as well. Navi just lost. We can talk about that coming through. But like I said, there's a couple important tournaments happening this weekend. CSGO Blast, Kanazaka, the Nexus Cup, LEC, LES, LCS, LCK, the Rainbow Six NA League Finals is happening right now this weekend as well. Madden 21 Club Championship and RLCS X Games is this weekend. There's a lot of tournaments going on, guys. I wouldn't miss this weekend at all, because of the fact there's so much shit happening. There's so many things going on. If we missed anything, please let us know. Maybe we'll create like an esports calendar, like esports weekend thing, like a graphic for you guys would be a good idea, where we could have like the tournaments happening this weekend and what you should watch and what are the most important tournaments this weekend. Because honestly, there's a lot of shit happening this weekend, and it seems like we're coming back full swing into esports, guys. Anthony Max, are you guys ready for this weekend, and specifically for the rest of the season, that esports are really becoming more prevalent and becoming more of a thing? Are you guys excited for this upcoming off break, basically back into the swing of things?
Pretty excited. Just leave it on this side of the monitor anyway.
Yeah, like I actually just keep it up on the side.
Yeah, I'm just watching it like all times.
Yeah, screw it, man.
Yeah, Max, nice thing to just put on the side.
Listen, man,
even watch it.
You're not a real avid esports fucking watcher if you don't have four boxes on one monitor and four boxes on another monitor with each Twitch chat individually separated out as well. If you're not doing that, then I don't even know what kind of filthy casual you guys fucking are, dude. Unbelievable.
Maybe I'll get a second monitor, put it on the top of my current one, and then, you know, it's just too big, too get huge ultra-wise, all just streams.
Get the full-on lab going. Get the full-on lab, the gaming lab going on. I think that'd be a good idea.
To focus on that many at once.
No, but that's the point. You go from one to one to one. You kind of like bounce around. You know what I'm saying? It's like your own professional player, but you're just watching the games. You're a professional watcher. You know what I'm saying? You're obviously not a professional watcher, Max. You need to get your head on a swivel. You know what I'm saying?
Puts my head on a swivel. I don't know what you mean.
You need to get like a full 360 setup. So you have like there, and then you like have to, there's like one behind you, go like turn your head around, you know what I'm saying? Or we could start watching in VR headsets, by the way. I think that might be a good idea. Maybe we could have, that way you wouldn't need to pay for extra monitors, right?
That would be cool.
And I think even Dota even used to do, or even added, Valve added their in-game system where you could actually watch the games from like inside the game, like in the map, you know what I mean? I think that'd be, there's many different ways to watch esports, but The most important one that could probably piss some people off that in the COD scene, I don't intend to. That's not my purpose, okay? The purpose here is not to do this. I mean, I've been watching COD League for the past year, so I feel confident saying my power rankings for this weekend and for COD League coming up for the rest of the year. Now, I don't entirely know everything about COD. I just want to make that clear. I just want to make that obvious that my power rankings are, first of all, not definitive, and second of all, I'm not a pro player in Call of Duty. Obviously, I'm not a pro player in Call of Duty. I only have my insights through Abizi, through FaZe Clan, through Rocker, some of those guys that I knew from the Atlanta FaZe team when I lived with them, and also the fact that I watched COD League pretty religiously over the past year during Overwatch League season. That was like my main source of entertainment. I watched COD League. I had a good time. So I feel like I can make a comment on this and hopefully not get ridiculed. If people hate this too much, then we won't do this again. But listen, I'm over here to make power rankings because of the fact that I think it's interesting. I think there's some cool moves people need to hear about, okay? I'll just go off and say it, all right? Number one, listen, I love Abizi. I think he's great. I think he's a great dude. I think FaZe Clan and Atlanta FaZe are a great team. But guess what? The Dallas Empire is still number one. The Dallas Empire have such a dominant roster with Shotzi, Illy, Huke, and Crimsix. Like, the team is so fucking good. And it's been so good for so long because of the fact, or for at least the past year. And the fact they won in such dominant fashion in those finals and throughout the year had pretty solid performances. And even in this offseason, during scrims, we've pretty much seen them be like a step ahead of everybody else. We pretty much see them be better than Optic, better than FaZe. And that's not to say that they're bad teams. It's just that Dallas Empire is that good, and that Dallas Empire is just really strong right now, honestly. Like, as a team, they're one of the best teams in COD League, and they're probably one of the... It looks like if they win another chip, might be one of the best teams of all time. Why are you hating my shirt, Daniel? Come on, you're distracting me here. Fuck you, dude. You hating my shirt? I hate you. But speaking about hating... I don't mean to hate on Atlanta FaZe. Like I said, Atlanta FaZe is still a great team. Beezy's a great guy. I think they have a good roster. And Abizi, Arcides, you know, Celium, Simp. They have probably the most talented, mechanically gifted roster in the entire league. You know, I think overall it makes it more talented and mechanically skilled than Dallas Empire because of, you know, Crimsix and Huke. I think they're great players, but at the same time, I don't know if they're on the level of this entire squad as well-rounded as them coming into this current year. But I think it's just like they're probably second place simply just because of the fact that Dallas Empire is performing better than them right now in scrims and stuff like that. But at the same time, it's getting newer. You know, there's more and more practice going on. There's more and more games happening in the behind the scenes, more streams happening, stuff like that, that it can prove otherwise. But currently, I'd say Atlanta FaZe, number two, I think, in this list is fair to say. They have a pretty high chance to be the best team in the league this year. But at the same time, it's like just based on current results and based on the previous results, we have to give Dallas Empire the edge over them. Now, I understand Optic fans might be upset. You might be pissed off. But I'd say look at the positives, okay? Look at the positives. Your team got rid of the Chicago Huntsman brand. Everybody hated it. All of the fans hated it. Even the Optic fans did. And now you finally have the Optic brand back. You should be proud. You should be celebrating this moment. Third place, though. I don't think we give them any higher than that in the current situation. I think they're competitive with FaZe right now, but I think comparing them to Dallas Empire, they haven't been as good. Dallas Empire has just been better as a team, honestly. But I think overall they have a chance to get better. Skump's still really good. Formal is frying. Formal is fucking frying. He might be back. He might be back. It's pretty awesome to see, to be honest with you. I think Optic have a pretty good chance of progressing through this tournament, through this year, honestly, at a high level. And it looks like so far they've been at a pretty solid level as well. But I think after that, we probably put Mutineers after Optic. I think after the top three, it's a little bit harder and everything's still up for debate. I think there could be some underdogs, some dark horses. So there's nothing really to get on about too much on these guys' cases. I'd say Mutineers is probably number four, though, honestly. They're looking solid, and they probably have the chance to be solid as well with pretty good results of the previous years. I think Rocker is higher than people would expect them currently. Rocker with the new additions of Major Maniac and Priest that make this roster pretty freaking good, pretty solid. They're well-rounded with some veterans and have some young talent in there as well. And then Subliners with the addition of Clay bolsters the roster right after Rocker. But with Zuma retiring, it kind of sets them back quite a little bit. They have picked up a new player, and in fact, Asim, I think his name is, right? Yeah, Asim officially joined the roster as of today. So overall, this roster has a chance to be solid and good. But at the same time, Zuma retiring does take back from this roster. But can Clay make it happen again? Is Clay the person that keeps getting kicked off of teams and can constantly build world-beating teams as well? Is he that guy? Because he keeps getting kicked from teams, but will always make himself known and make himself a presence in the server and make himself one of the best COD League, one of the GOAT players of all time in Call of Duty. And then LA Thieves, I think this might be a little bit controversial probably after then. I think Optic looked good throughout the year, but kind of faltered in the playoffs last year. Optic being the same team, by the way, LA Thieves rebranded, for people that don't know, rebranded from Optic Gaming in previous years. Basically, so what happened was last year, Optic was bought out by Immortals Gaming Club and branded for Optic Gaming, basically. They basically stole the brand from Hex. Now, Hex bought that brand back. Immortals Gaming Club sold their roster slot to Nadeshot and 100 Thieves. And now 100 Thieves owns LA Thieves, which it kind of has a similar roster in that team. I mean, they have Temp now, but it's still Slasher and Kenny. So that team looks pretty freaking solid. But at the same time, I don't know if I would rank them higher than we are below subliners and stuff like that. You know, I mean, I don't know if I would do that, to be honest with you. But I think Seattle Surge is probably the next up after LA Thieves. I think Seattle Surge finally is building around Octane. That's good to hear. To be honest with you, Octane, for those of you who don't know, has been carrying his ass off in Seattle Surge, putting up fucking insane numbers, one of the best players in the league. Yet it seems like they can never build a team around him. Some people call him a stat padder. Some people call him somebody that just comes into the league and actually doesn't perform to that high of a level. But now, coming into this year, I think Seattle Surge has really built the roster around them. I think we're probably underranking them, to be honest with you. They finally added Pristini and Gunless to the roster so they could take it up to another level. I'm just hoping this team has no internal struggles between Octane, between Pristini and Gunless, because Gunless had problems in the Chicago Huntsman previous year. So I think overall this team can do good, and I think it should do good, honestly. I hope Seattle Surge does well. I hope Octane does well. I'm pulling for him. He's been in content creation and kind of been pulling up. Now, the rest of these bottom four, five teams, to be honest with you, I think it's up in a mix. I think some of these teams are probably underrated. I think Ultra looks really good, but I think Royal Ravens, probably, where have I been so far? So Dallas Empire, number one. Atlanta FaZe, number two. Optic, number three. Mutineers, four. Rocker, five. Subliners, six. Thieves, seven, I think, in the roster so far. So Seattle Surge, eight. And I think Royal Ravens might be number nine here. Royal Ravens had a pretty good last year. They played pretty solid. And I think this year it's no different. I think Alex looks really good, and this Royal Ravens squad has a chance to be pretty good overall. And I think they have bolstered their roster in a way that can make them outperform expectations this year. Then I would put Ultra probably at, where am I, at 10 or 9 or something? Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, they're probably at 9-ish or whatever for this upcoming year. I think Ultra looks pretty good. Cammy looks pretty solid. Ultra as a roster is looking better than people would expect. Now, next up, after Ultra, Paris Legion. Probably another dark horse coming into this upcoming year. Again, new players, new roster. It's maybe not as prominent as people would like, but I think, again, like just like last year, Paris is kind of being in not just necessarily a budget mode. But yeah, I mean, they're budget mode. Paris Legion's in budget mode for this year, but really with the league's parity, it's probably going to be better roster than people would expect. That there's really, I think COD League has said this before, there's really no bad teams in COD League, to be honest with you, this year. But I think, unfortunately, we got to put LA Gorillas at the last team this year. Unfortunately for them, since going from LAN to online, they haven't looked as good in this coming year. Thank you, Daniel, for the graphic. But LA Gorillas, unfortunately for them, I don't think I would put them top of the roster. They really haven't been great since coming to the online scene. They were doing really good in the beginning of COD League Season 1, but then fell off once they swapped to online and didn't get to take advantage of the online scene anymore. They've made some changes, and they could progress here. So we shouldn't rank them too lowly, but we are going to. That's my top 12 COD League power rankings, and I'm ready to be scrutinized for everything I've said today on stream.
Who was the guy who got kicked off their team?
Off of which team?
I don't know. You were talking about some guy who kept on getting kicked off teams, but kept on making better
Clayster.
Teams.
Clayster. That was the guy that basically, I think, Abizi told us the other day, where Abizi basically told us, Clayster is a shady motherfucker. Like, this guy, he's older. He's in the scene because he's so talented and such a good leader that he keeps basically, there's like a meme. It's like, Clayster and two rookies once again come to the, you know, make it to the finals or whatever. Like, it's like his thing, you know? He keeps getting booted even though he's pretty fucking solid.
Why does he get booted? They don't like him?
No. It's not that they don't like him. It's just that he's the worst player on the best roster. It's like, that's the situation at hand. And last year, I think they would have kept him. But basically, COD League went from 5v5 to 4v4, so you had to remove somebody from your roster. And unfortunately, that was Clayster in the past year. I think everybody said it was Clayster. Now, Clayster still played really good, but it's like he's the worst player on the best team. It's like, I don't know if that's necessarily even a bad thing, because that still makes him, you know, top 10 player probably in the world, maybe top 15 player in the world or whatever. And the fact that he's such a good leader and can always bring up these new and upcoming talent to the top is kind of what happens with Shotzi and Illy of the previous years. They were kind of unknown. But Clayster took that roster and made it really good and outperformed expectations. And that looks like it's what's going to happen in Subliners once again. But yeah, BZ told us how he always finds like sneaky stuff, like the name tag situation that he found, where he could see like enemy name tags basically on SND and maps like that, where you can see them before, you know, you can actually see the character model. So he would see their name tags and kill them through walls and shit like that.
Is that not cheating? It's kind of like the CSGO bug.
He's abusing game mechanics, and I think Abizi said that he didn't expect anybody to actually do that. But it is kind of cheating at the same time. It's like, the thing is, it's not, though, because COD kind of knows that there's going to be so many bugs. Like, they release a new COD every year, and it's like, okay, this game is going to be a buggy mess for the most part. Yeah, they got to keep releasing it no matter what, right?
Fair enough.
Yeah. Well, that's... The Olaf boost. But
I'm muted. I'm trolling.
Anthony's apparently muted. He had some important information. I can speak for him. He basically brought up the Olaf Meister boost that happened in previous years. And the fact that, you know, I think overall, these things don't really go punished because of the fact that I think the players kind of have organized, and how it's always been, COD League's always been grassroots. So COD League's always kind of been not as franchised as it is now, which last year was the first time franchising happened for Call of Duty. And Call of Duty, the players, first of all, didn't like it. Like, over the first year, players, obviously, Abizi's talked well about it. He likes it. But there's been a lot of complaints from the COD League admins, from the COD League as a whole, the observing, you know, the pretty much everything. But they had to kind of figure out how to make it a franchise system, because they made it a franchise system similar to Overwatch League. And Activision's kind of doing this kind of situation. And people aren't happy with how Activision's kind of been going in this path with Blizzard, where it's like the Blizzard path of old is dead, the grassroots is dead, and now it's on to a big market, you know, Activision, massive corporation situation. And that's the situation that's happening with COD League, where originally it was very much so grassroots, like we said. And now, because it's become franchised, players are having kind of a worse situation, in which that they've always kind of dealt with GAs and stuff like that themselves. And now they have a third party basically coming in and telling them what to do, instead of it being as grassroots as it once was. So that's kind of how the COD League is kind of shaping up to be. Like I said, I know people maybe don't care as much as COD League as I do. I personally care about it a lot because I love Call of Duty. I love the COD League as a whole. I know Anthony hates COD, obviously. He's a big fucking hater. But, you know, we don't judge him for that. You know what I'm saying? We don't judge him for that. And Abizi mentioned as well, before we move on to the next topic, that Optic and Dallas are also doing well. And Rocker is also looking to defy expectations as well. Guys, we can move on to another topic that has to do with Call of Duty and cheating. Like we said, seems like every week we talk about cheaters. Seems like every day, every hour, every second of our life has involved cheaters. Now, why isn't it? Why is there so many cheaters in the world, huh? Why are there so many bad people on this planet willing to cheat in tournaments? In a recent Twitch Rivals tournament, there's been Warzone cheaters. In a recent Twitch Rivals tournament, in a $250,000 tournament, it was scandalized by cheating accusations. Once again, Tommy, the Twitch streamer in Warzone, a big Twitch streamer in Warzone, has accused more players of cheating. Metzi was apparently using an aimbot in the Twitch Rivals tournament. in a trio squad tournament starring some of the biggest names in Warzone. It had high profiles. High profile figures in this. Metzi was using aimbot. According to Tommy, there was a clip where he was showing Metzi's reticle shift quickly to a player who jumped out of a window. And then he was apparently playing on a controller, so apparently that makes it possible that it happened. But Tommy was still accusing him of cheating, and a lot of people are still getting on Metzi's case. Apparently, according to what Sam and according to Rin, which did a lot of the research on this one, the broadcast was stopped for about an hour while the officials investigated. And Metzi said on the stream that he received a message from Twitch saying it was determined that the gameplay was unnatural. Beyond reasonable doubt. So now Twitch is coming out and basically saying that Metzi was cheating when he potentially wasn't. And this has kind of been a big scandal. It seems like Tommy's the guy in Warzone that keeps accusing people of cheating. Is Tommy the Kefri of Warzone? That seems like what's happening. The 0.25 situation where he's watching back these clips and accusing people of cheating might turn out poorly for Tommy. I think that the situation right now is working in his favor. It's getting him more views. It's gaining him more traction. Calling out cheaters has never been a bad thing to a lot of people. But once you start calling people cheaters who are not, then it becomes a bigger situation than Tommy can handle. I think it becomes a situation where he's going to be, you know, hated by the community. I think it's working out his favor because Warzone has been known to have cheaters go on for quite some time now. Honestly, it's been such a thing that's wreaking havoc on Warzone that people have quit Warzone because of how many cheaters there are. And it's basically this guy's been, he's had multiple cheating accusations. Apparently, it's confirmed that Metzi was cheating, so he was booted from the tournament. This is a quote here from Twitch Rivals. During the Twitch Rivals Doritos Bowl feat Call of Duty Warzone Finals, Metzi B was ruled to be cheating. As a result, his team was removed from the event. We take Twitch Rivals player conduct extremely seriously, and we will continue to investigate any allegations of cheating. This is kind of the situation that's been going on for Warzone for a while, like we've said. And the fact this happened in the Twitch Rivals tournament is pretty fucking massive news. When is Activision going to take action on Warzone, and when are they going to finally actually take care of these cheaters that have been rampaging through Warzone for basically the past year? They've been absolutely dominating the lobbies for the past year, and people have been calling for an anti-cheat for a while, and yet Activision's solution is basically just to make blacklisted servers for cheaters and stuff like that. I don't know if Activision is necessarily doing the right thing here, guys. I've got to be real. Activision is dropping the ball once again. It's kind of like it's part of their brand to just absolutely drop the ball in these situations and make it a lot worse than it needs to be, right? Like, when is Activision going to make an anti-cheat? That's the question we need to ask ourselves right now, Max and Anthony.
Wait, so you're saying that they don't have any anti-cheat at all?
It's just really bad, I'm pretty sure. We could probably do some more research. I'm sure Sam and Sam and the people behind the scenes can help us out here, but I'm pretty sure for the most part it's just really poor. And from what I heard from Aimbot Calvin, from my friend Calvin, he basically said how they just put cheaters into a server together, and that's what they do. They put you in this like shadow realm. So it's just a bunch of cheaters versus each other, basically.
Well, that's actually a nice option. I know, I remember Fall Guys, I think, did that, where they had like a cheater island.
Oh, yeah? But
I don't know. That's probably more effort than what they deserve.
No, yeah.
But still, do they not even have like a report system?
I think they do. Yeah, I think they do. They do have a report system, but it's kind of ineffective, I'm pretty sure. Like, there's stream snipers, cheaters, and stuff like, and all the like. Okay, here apparently. So this is just an update as of 9/30/2020 from Daniel. This is from September, basically, from Infinity Ward. They said, anti-cheat update. Since launch, the team has banned over 200,000 accounts for cheating across Warzone and Modern Warfare, including a new wave this week. So this was back in September. We're continuing to deploy additional security updates and added back-end enforcement tools. Zero tolerance for cheating. Now, this is obviously not true. They banned 200,000 people, but guess what? There's 200 more thousand people cheating, and especially in Twitch Rivals if you're having this issue. What the fuck are you doing? What are you doing, Infinity Ward, if you're saying you're banning these people, and yet they somehow managed to snake their way in to Twitch Rivals? What maybe, are you doing?
Maybe these guys are like, they're good until they get to the big stage, and then the big stage are like, I'm gonna impress people with my shots.
No, 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 no. Actually
matters.
No way. No way. These guys are always cheating. There's no way Activision and Infinity Ward's anti-cheat is even halfway decent if the fact that these people are getting through for this long. And I think that people have said that these cheaters don't get banned for so fucking long, and it's a bit ridiculous. Like, they can keep streaming, they can keep being, you know, more well-known people, and the fact that they don't even get these people banned, like, that are live streaming on Twitch, is a bit hilarious. You know what I'm saying? I guess the same thing's happened in Overwatch. Like, I think recently, the reason we're bringing this up as well is because Soda Poppin' really recently dealt with a Soldier 76 cheating in Overwatch ranked as well. And it seems like Activision and as a company as a whole hasn't really dealt with cheaters to a high level just yet. Now, we don't have as big of a cheating scandal in Overwatch because the game's not free to play. I think it's a little bit harder to ban people when it's a free to play game because they can kind of keep making accounts, right? They can keep VPNing so they don't get IP banned or whatever, hardware banned. There's ways around that kind of situation, and it seems like Activision Blizzard doesn't really do a good job with it simply because of the fact that it's a free-to-play game. Is that an excuse, though? Is the fact that it's free-to-play really an excuse, the fact they have so many cheaters?
No. Definitely still make attempts at just doing hardware bans and IP bans. Like, there's no reason not to be doing that. There's no reason to only just ban the account, because, like you said, they'll just make more accounts. It doesn't actually prevent anything.
No, it doesn't. It really doesn't, and it seems like Activision has done a pretty poor job. Over the weekend, to be honest with you. Guys, important information. More topics to go off. We're going to go off of this one here because this one is important to me simply because today is a fucking grind, boys. Today is a goddamn grind and a half. Tonight, this weekend in Overwatch, Nexus Cup is happening. 2021 Nexus Cup is happening once again. Just a few months ago, we watched another Chinese tournament happen. Another Chinese event happening with Guangzhou Charge, Shanghai Dragons, Spark, and what was the fourth team? Seoul Dynasty. Either way, we watched four teams basically battle it out a couple months ago. This weekend as well, today, tonight at 11 p.m. I think our time, or maybe 1 a.m. our time. I don't know if that's actually true. I will co-stream this event. I'm going to co-cast this event pretty much, or watch this event tonight. Watch it on my Twitch channel at twitch.tv/Dusttin Bowerman. We're probably going to be playing marbles tonight. We're probably relaxing, watching this tournament. I'll give you my predictions right now, though, for this week's Nexus Cup, for this weekend's Nexus Cup. Dallas Fuel's playing in this event, by the way. Dallas Fuel, the Shanghai Dragons, Charge, and Seoul Dynasty are all in this event. And people probably say Shanghai Dragons is going to win this tournament. Once again, Shanghai Dragons probably will win this tournament again. I think I won't predict against that. I don't know if Dallas Fuel will do as well as everybody says. I don't know if Dallas Fuel will play as to a high level in which everybody says. I think that they have a good roster and a good team. I think they probably need some more time to synergize. But in order for Dallas Fuel to beat Seoul Dynasty and to beat Shanghai Dragons, it's going to be hard. It's going to be tough. They have a good roster, but the parity in the league is so fucking good that I don't know if Dallas Fuel will actually compete to the highest level with Shanghai Dragons with Seoul Dynasty. I think they'll beat Charge. Listen, I don't want to shit on Charge too much here, but I'm going to anyways. I don't think Charge is doing that well recently. And I think that their team is kind of heading in a weird direction because I've heard from behind the scenes, not just this year, but in the previous years, that their coaches run Charge like a sweatshop. Like, their coaches are basically telling them to keep playing the game, to watch VODs, to play Overwatch 24/7 nearly, to wear to the fact that they're dead before the matches even start. Like, the guys are just on the ground just... Now, I don't know if I'm over-exaggerating, I get that. I understand this is an entirely over-exaggeration. But Charge players are literally fucking dead, just dying on their goddamn desk. Like, I don't even know what the hell is happening with them, to be honest with you. But they haven't been performing that well. Like, they got to change something up. I think that Charge has to do some sort of structural change. Because, to be honest, I can't really see Charge outperforming than what they did last year. I think last year they had a good year. Krong's still a good player, and that team was pretty good, but they lost some crucial members in Nero, and in Happy, and a couple other players as well. They lost some pretty big names during the offseason, and now I don't know if they're going to be able to live up to the last year's, like, they were pretty much the second best team in Korea. They were pretty much the second best team in Korea, like, to be honest with you, over the course of last year in Overwatch League. But now it seems like they've kind of taken a dramatic drop off. In the previous tournament, they got absolutely shit on by basically everybody. And now coming into this Nexus Cup, I think the exact same thing's going to happen. Now, I want them to prove me wrong. I want Charge to prove me wrong. I'm going to pull a Shaq scenario. Basically, yesterday, Shaq on the NBA on TNT pretty much told Donovan Mitchell, an NBA player that's a top NBA player, he's like, "You're shit." He was like, to his face, he said, "You're trash." And I'm kind of going in that same route. It's not exactly professional, and it's not exactly courteous. Guangzhou Charge, "You're trash." I'm sorry. That's just the case. But I think that they can do well. I think they could do well this weekend. I think they could do phenomenal this weekend. I hope they do. But to be honest with you, I think Seoul Dynasty, Shanghai Dragons, the Dallas Fuel even will have an edge over them coming into this weekend. I think people are most excited to see Dallas Fuel. I'm probably most excited to see Dallas Fuel, not because I'm a fan of them, but because so many people are hyped up for them. So many people are fans, sorry, of the Dallas Fuel. And to be honest with you, I'm excited to see them do well. I want them to do well. But I think rankings-wise for this weekend, Shanghai Dragons number one, Seoul Dynasty number two, and Dallas Fuel number three, and then probably Guangzhou Charge, the fourth best team in this here tournament. And I don't know. I'm excited for this event. I'm going to be watching it, obviously, this weekend. And I just don't think that Charge is going to do too well. I think people that are Charge fans are not going to be happy with that situation. But guess what? That's just how it fucking is, okay? That's just how it goddamn is sometimes with Overwatch, with Nexus Cup, you know, with all the situation going on right now as well. But also, speaking of which, Kanazaka tournaments this weekend, speaking of things I'm involved in, just, I know this is a little bit of a shout-out too much here, but this Sunday, I will be helping host the Kanazaka tournament. I will be helping them out. I don't know exactly what the role is just yet, if it's officially announced just yet, but we will be going on the broadcast for Kanazaka with Monkey Bubble and stuff like that this weekend. I don't know if that's too early of a leak. If they're mad at me, I'm sorry, but that's happening this weekend. We're going to be going over that community event. It's going to be fun. Now, like I said, this weekend will be a grind, boys, okay? This weekend will be a fucking grind. Tonight is the Nexus Cup. This weekend, bunch of tournaments, like we said. And then over the weekend, also Kanazaka is going on with that hosting event on 11 a.m. So it's going to be like after the show, we immediately go on to watching the Nexus Cup. And then after that, there's the Kanazaka event and stuff like that. So it's an exciting weekend, guys. It's a fucking massive weekend. And I hope Charge fans aren't too mad at me, to be honest with you. I mean, they probably are at this point. I understand what I'm saying is upsetting to hear, but I don't know if you could beat the likes of Shanghai Dragons when the matter of the fact is they were probably one of the best teams in the Overwatch League. They have the reigning MVP in Fleta. And to be honest with you, the roster is pretty bolstered up for this year. Their roster is looking pretty solid. And I don't know if they're actually going to do as you know, I don't know if they're going to win the tournament necessarily, but I think with Fate, with the addition of Fate, it's looking pretty solid for them overall. Wait, it's Fate, right? I needed some fact checks here. I'm sorry if I get that wrong. But Shanghai Dragons are looking very, very solid, honestly, this weekend. And I hope Dallas Fuel does well with their changes as well, but I don't know if they will. I don't know if they're going to be honest with you. Moving on to Counter-Strike here, guys. There's some important news going on. But CSGO Blast Premiere has happened today and is happening over the course of this weekend. CSGO Blast has been the premier tournament right now for Counter-Strike for this weekend. Usually there's been more events in Counter-Strike, but since COVID, it slowed down a little bit. But Premier is happening this weekend, and Na'Vi actually won today against G2 in their loser bracket semifinals, which is pretty awesome to see, considering Liquid, the team they're going up against next, beat them in the upper bracket quarters, and then they came down, and then progressed, and now it's Team Liquid versus Na'Vi in that finals loser bracket match. And I think people are excited because Team Liquid looks good. Team Liquid looks fucking solid. I mean, yes, they lost, I think, to Vitality, I believe it was. They lost to Vitality. But, You know, I think they still look pretty good with the change with Fallen, with Twist gone. They're actually looking like a pretty solid roster. And this is only their first tournament. You know what I'm saying? This is only their first tournament together. They look pretty fucking good, to be honest with you. And so is Na'Vi. That's why this matchup's so good, because Na'Vi just absolutely decimated G2, even with a hot Nico. Even with Nico being on fire, G2 absolutely got shit on by Na'Vi. Flame, he showed up. Fucking Simple absolutely showed up. He had some sick no-scopes, some sick shots. Simple with the AWP is a force of nature right now on another level than pretty much everybody else. Obviously not Zywoo. I mean, that's just how it is. I was pretty nuts still. Speaking of which, in the upper bracket finals, it's Astralis Vitality. Astralis lost the map during their run to that, but Vitality has not. Vitality has so far gone undefeated in the upper bracket finals, and they are playing against each other. It's kind of interesting because Vitality is probably still not the favorite for this tournament. Vitality has HLTV's ranked number one player. However, and I don't know if it really matters into the fact that Astralis is pretty much the top team right now and will probably be the top team for at least a little bit, which is interesting because they're going through some turmoil. Astralis is going through some turmoil over the past year in which that players wanted a break because a lot of their players were getting burnt out. A lot of their players, Glaive was getting burned out. You know what I'm saying? Like Dupree was getting burned out. Device was getting burned out. And now where they had a bunch of like pretty much bench players come in to fill their roster out, they're finally kind of back. They're back in form. They look fucking good. They look god tier almost. And they're kind of getting into a groove where they're set to be the favorite for this tournament. They're set to be favorites for this Blast Premier tournament. And that's kind of exciting to see, to be honest with you, because of the fact that I've been a big Astralis fan for the past years. Like I said, back when they were Team Dignitas, I was a big fan of them. But now they're actually getting back into shape and getting back into form. And that's pretty fucking awesome to see, to be honest with you. But apparently, also more Counter-Strike news. 35 CSGO player has been banned in Australia, plus two ban extensions. They haven't been accused of match-fixing, but there's an investigation, basically. They have been betting on events. These 35 players in CSGO have been betting on events, ESIC events, including their own games. They've been betting on their own games. And now, listen, I've thought of this before in the past, okay? Back in Overwatch League, I won't deny it. I've thought of it, but I never did. Because of the fact that there's literally no money to be made compared to what you're actually making in these events. It's pretty fucking stupid. It's pretty goddamn stupid to bet on your own events and your bet on your own team. Like, who the fuck does that, man? Like, what goes through your brain, Max and Anthony, that you actually go and bet on your team? I mean, is it just because you're so poor? If you were in, like, for example, guys, if you were, example, in one of these tier three teams and you had the opportunity to bet on yourself and bet, like, I don't know, $10,000 on yourself and you'd make $20,000, would you risk your entire future on that scenario, basically?
Sure, why not?
What? What do you mean?
Maybe.
It's a lot of money. Maybe. And if you don't get caught and you're so sure of yourself that you're going to win, then hey, why not?
Bro, get that money. You're telling me you would throw away your potential career to make hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars for 20 grand. Yes?
Like, let's be real here. These guys probably not going to make too much money off of CSGO.
True. And it seems like for the most part, Valorant's being like that safe haven for cheaters and match fixers and whatever else, right? Yeah, like, it seems like people are like Riot's like, hey, yeah, you cheated. Oh, hey, yeah, you match fixed. Come on over. Come on over to Valorant. We'll save you. And it seems like that's probably the route these guys are taking. They're like, okay, I'm done with my Counter-Strike career. I'm not going to be any better than a tier three player. You're right. Maybe why not match fix? What's the downside?
Yeah, pretty much. It's time to just go to Valorant. Like, who cares?
Well, do you think that Valorant should do anything about these match fixes and cheaters and stuff?
I mean, if they didn't even do anything in their game, so it sounds kind of iffy if they want to look at some other games and see what, like, the history people did in other games.
Yeah. Well, there's still investigations, by the way, going on for, you know, the players in the Mountain Dew League that apparently match fixed. That's still, there's still an investigation going on with them. And in Valorant, there's still that going on because they basically, for those of you who don't know, there was a bunch of tier three players, basically a bunch of premier players in the Mountain Dew League in NA for Counter-Strike that pretty much like a year ago, I guess, have match fixed. They basically threw for money, threw for skins or whatever. And then now it's basically being rebrought up and reinvestigated because these very same players have played now professional Valorant matches. They've now played a few professional Valorant matches whilst this investigation is going on. I don't think there's a conclusion just yet. I could be proven wrong about this, but the investigation isn't done just yet. And I think for that's just kind of going back into Counter-Strike, where it just seems like a lot of these players that are giving up on Counter-Strike are going to go cheat in Valorant because, like you said, there's no punishment. Like, if you're not going to make any money in Counter-Strike, what's the point, right?
Yeah, it's like, I don't know. Are they going to get money either way?
No, I mean, probably not that much. I imagine these match-fixing events probably have to do with Russia. Probably have to do with some offshore fucking... because that's what it is. Pretty much a lot of these betting websites are based in Russia and stuff like that. I think I don't know if CSGO Lounge is based in Russia and stuff like that, but for the most part, it seems like... it seems like, to be honest with you, these Counter-Strike, there's not really much money to be made. So you might as well start match fixing. Now, that's not to say that I ever match fix in Overwatch 2, by the way. Like, that's never been a thing. I'd never even bet even on any game or any sport or esport, because that's literally in the Overwatch League contract to not bet on sports or esports, electronic sports or anything. Like, you're not allowed to. It's literally written in the contract.
Not even other esports?
No. You can't bet at all. I think that's actually like a common thing across all sports, is like you can't bet on any sort of sport. I'm pretty sure it's just like against it's just like against the moral code or something. It's like just not allowed, you know? It's just like permanently against the rules to always bet on sports if you're playing in an esport or whatever. And people do it anyway. People are dumb enough to fucking do it anyway, right? So, I don't know. I wouldn't in Overwatch League, but I guess if you're in some sort of tier 3 team in Australia, why not?
I mean, they're probably not going to make it big. They won't have the same name that, like, TenZ had.
What, in Counter-Strike?
No, in Valorant.
You're right. They might not. And I don't know how many good... I mean, I'm sure there's probably one or, like, a couple Australian and, like, good players from the Oceanic region in Valorant that we just haven't heard of. Because for the most part, like, you have to, in order to make for a name yourself when you're in Australia, when you're in the Oceanic region, it seems like you have to move over to America. Like, that's just what happens, is that the only way to make a name for yourself in the scene is to move over from Australia, just because the Oceanic scenes aren't really that, like, popular, to be honest with you. Like, I don't know how many, I mean, we've talked about, like, Anna and Dota being, like, a really talented player. I think Anna and Dota got Radiant in Valorant. Like, he was a pretty fucking good Valorant player after being a Dota 2 pro player. But it's like a lot of these players have to, like, move over from Australia to really have a chance. And it's like somebody said, I think Super or somebody said on a podcast recently I watched. Oh, it was on Plat Chat. It was on Plat Chat. On Plat Chat, they mentioned how Adam just got picked up for LA Valiant. And then he was an Australian player that got picked up for this year. And then LA Valiant got sold to a Chinese company and got immediately dropped. So he just got his first opportunity to play in Overwatch League and was about to play. And then boom, fucking dropped before the season even starts and he gets no opportunity.
Oh, that's like,
really a shame.
It's a shame because a lot of these players in Australia don't get a fucking shot. A lot of these players in Brazil, for example, don't get a fucking shot. A lot of them should, but unfortunately don't, just because of the fact of where they live. You know, unfortunate spawn, as some say. You know what I'm saying? Unfortunate spawn location, IRL, for them, you know, in Australia and stuff like that. And I've heard some interesting stories about Australia, you know what I'm saying? I grew up as a kid thinking they didn't have cars and only had trains and horses. So I was incredibly stupid as a kid, believing this rumor that Australia was full of horses and drug addicts. But in fact, it is not. In fact, Australia is a thriving country that in fact just doesn't have... it has very passionate players, though. I will say, Australia does have very passionate players. It's just sad that their scene really doesn't have... some structure, to be honest with you, and it doesn't have the exposure.
Like, at least in Overwatch, don't they have a Contenders League?
Yeah, they do, and they had a pretty dominant team called the Sydney Drop Bears, which was dominant for a super long time. I don't know if they're still dominant. Maybe I should get some research up on my Contenders scene. But yeah, They had a contender scene. It's just, unfortunately for them, it's just like Brazil and a couple of these other scenes that aren't as prominent as the NA region or Europe. I mean, even Europe's kind of fallen off. Or like Korea, mainly just Korea. I mean, like China also has one too, and they also have Team CC and has been good in China. But, you know, it's just not as prominent, you know, which is kind of unfortunate because Australia is a pretty big country. It's just their esports scene hasn't been as dominant and as it doesn't have the publicity, basically, that the same degree of these other of the other scenes. And that's why you kind of have to move to America. I think Custa probably talked about this before, where Custa had to move the caster and former professional player for the LA Valiant. He had to move from Australia to America to really have a shot at playing professional Overwatch. You know, that's just why that was the case. That was the only way he would get his shot at the pro leagues was if he moved to America to play on Arc 6 and to play with, you know, the guys ZZA, Ginger Pop, with XQC and that crew. Basically, Custa was the guy to join those teams and play on Fnatic early on in the scene and kind of make a name for himself that way. But that's a huge risk. Like, imagine being some fucking kid in Australia. It's like, yep, I'm going to just move to America, move my entire life over to America to try to make it in professional esports, which, to be honest with you, makes good money. It makes solid money, but it's not, I don't know if it would be entirely worth moving your entire life over from, you know, an area just to get a shot, right? It's like you're moving cultures almost. We speak the same language, but, you know, it's a big cultural move from Australia to America still, right?
Yeah, like, what? Where is he going to get his visa too? Because that's like a huge thing that even companies have a hard time doing.
Oh, yeah.
It's probably even harder to do it as an individual.
Yeah, you just got to come in as an illegal immigrant and hope it works out, right?
Yeah, from Australia.
From an illegal immigrant from Australia. Yes, yeah, swim the whole distance.
Why would you go to Korea?
Learn Korean. Yeah, but that Korea is a hard language. I mean, actually, is it that hard? I mean, just From English to Korean, I've tried learning Korean, which is kind of interesting because their alphabet and their words actually are supposed to mimic. It's kind of interesting. They're supposed to mimic the face, the like how your face is supposed to look while you're saying those words and vowels and stuff. I don't know if you knew that. So it's like a simplified language. It's like, I could be entirely wrong. I could get pissed off, like a lot of Korean fans getting pissed off at me. But basically it was like, I think their guy, like the big guy in Korea, basically took the Chinese language and simplified it almost. Or it was either Chinese or Japanese. I think it was Chinese.
I don't know,
this is history that I was told to by a Korean person. I hope that I'm not getting my facts too wrong here. But they basically like simplified it and made it so like your mouth would look like what you're saying. And that's kind of how it looks, to be honest. I don't know. I tried learning Korean. I kind of gave up because learning an Asian language from English speaking languages are incredibly difficult. And especially since I'm a white Jewish kid that only knows one language, I don't think I have a good chance of learning Korean unless I spent the next 10 years learning Korean and being some shitty Korean translator, to be honest with you. But it looks like we're ready for our boy Samito to come on the show. So we'll try getting him in here, guys. We're going to end this segment and end this off early because we have basically two massive guests coming in today. We had a pre-recorded session with Super at like 11 a.m. today. He had to stream. I think he's going to be live right now. So I don't know if he's watching this currently. I think there's a chance he is. But he's going to be on at 4:30. His episode's on 4:30. And then we have Samito on right now coming on immediately as soon as we can get him in here. Let's get him in here then, boys. Wait, Samito, you're not ready. What are you doing? I got to give you your intro, bro. What are you doing to me, man? All right. Our guest today is a man who some say looks exactly like me, a man whose Minecraft skills were unmatched before everyone else hopped onto this hype train of the Dream SMP crew, and a man who's extremely passionate for Overwatch, Samito! Let's go!
Yeah, let's go.
Good, man. How you doing, bro? Yeah. Well, let's see where we actually are. There we go. There you are. Oh my God, you're frozen, Samito. You're not here in one piece. Oh no. We lost contact with Samito on the stream. Oh shit. We were too early.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we were a bit. Yeah, you can hear you now. You're good. No, it's okay. We were early. This is earlier than we thought because, you know, we wanted to keep things rolling and we wanted to get you on immediately. So usually we spend like 10 minutes getting a guest on, but we got you in literally like within 2 minutes. So thanks for being patient. I appreciate you being here in a hurry, dude.
Yeah, listen, man. I guess they didn't hear me, but I'm really excited to be on. You know, I think this is right up your alley. And, you know, I'd love to just talk with you, bro. So it's always a good time to be around.
Let's chat. Well, I wanted you to, thanks for saying that, by the way. But speaking of which, I mean, I mentioned how you were playing Minecraft before you got into Overwatch. Why the fuck did you quit Minecraft, bro? Why'd you quit Minecraft?
I just, you know, I cannot do anything I don't love with my life. Yeah. And I think the way that he took the game just was not up my alley. I was kind of burned out. And Overwatch came out too at the same time. So when all that happens, it's like, okay. You know, I fell in love with Overwatch. I wanted to take my career away from, like, I wanted to work with adults as well. I didn't want to be in a community, like, of younger people.
Samito.
Yeah.
You came into Overwatch.
Yeah, I know.
My guy.
Yeah.
This is all kids. Well, actually, no, we are growing up now. Okay, that is, too, you know, to be fair. Mm-hmm. We are growing up. Well, sorry, I want to let you keep talking, but I just wanted
to... No, you're good. Well, I mean, you got to understand Minecraft, too. I'm talking really young. Like I'm not talking, true. Like, young side of Overwatch is probably, like, you know, early teens, maybe, right? Minecraft is like 8 years old, and it's just like, dude, I listen, best of luck to you and your childhood and whatever, but like, there's way more adults in this industry, and I follow my heart. That's all I could do, you know?
So were you looked up as like a role model basically in Minecraft and stuff like that? Like people were looking at you in that light pretty much back when you were content creating for it?
I mean, I never saw it like that. To this day, I don't see it like that. I think everyone's human, and I think the world would be better if we all saw each other like that, you know?
True, I agree, yeah.
Yes and no, I guess. I don't know. Maybe my perspective on it being a social media whatever is totally backwards. But I would never admit it, no. I felt like I was just a guy, and I would always shoot straight with people and talk to anybody and just enjoy conversation. So, you know, I don't know. Maybe that's a bad answer, I guess. But
No, that makes sense, because I think when people realize, like, when you go to like BlizzCon or something like that, if you could probably test this as well. Mm-hmm. When you meet some of these people in person, like when you meet you in person, or when you meet somebody like XQC or myself or another pro or something like that, another streamer, J3 or something like that, when you meet them in person, they're pretty human. I mean, they're humans. They're literally humans like anybody else. So it's just like, it's different. It's just like, it's what you see online is not necessarily the same thing you see in person, although it kind of is. Mm-hmm. It is quite different. But like, I guess when you look online, when you look at these people like yourself, people in the past, I mean, people are seen as role models and stuff like that. Do you think, this is kind of a question I have, Samito, what your opinion, I guess, kind of on the more human aspect. Do you think people should be more aware of the platform they have, though, and be like, okay, you know, in this situation, my audience is a bunch of kids. I probably shouldn't be pull a Joe Rogan and talk about DMT and mushrooms and shit like that.
Yeah,
if my entire audience is kids, right?
I think it wouldn't hurt, but I think it goes both ways. I think that especially now with social media is just incredibly critical of people, like, and they're more so now than ever, right? And I think that there's a middle ground being, instead of just being very critical of content creators and how they express their views, and actually helping them become aware of what it is they do. Cause like, I think even now, like it's really hard to fathom. Like when you're playing an Overwatch League, right? Mm-hmm. How hard was it for you? Sorry to answer a question with a question, to kind of like understand how many people were watching you play or how you were changing. Like, did you just see it as like, you're playing the game and I'm just worried about the game? Because I feel like a lot of, like, at least in OWL, like, people think like that, where it's like, listen, I'm just here to play the game. They don't understand their entertainers, influencers, you name it, right? At least for me, I don't know. I think it goes both ways. I think that, it's been tough for me to get my mind around that too, where it's like, yo, like, people listen to what you have to say. And I've just sat here at my desk since I was 19 years old playing video games. That perspective is very hard to get, especially now with no conventions or anything, where that's where you would go to get that perspective.
Yeah. Well, I mean, to answer your question too, I mean, like when you're playing on stage and when you're doing that kind of stuff in the audience, what, from my perspective, it's kind of like a similar human aspect, like you said, where I was just kind of playing on stage, and especially like some of my biggest moments when I call crews a feeder and stuff like that. It's like in that moment, it's just like, what's kind of like, I'm just playing the game. I'm just trash talking. It's fun. And then, you know, come nightfall, I check the internet and it's like, oh my God, everyone's fucking hating on this situation. Holy shit. What the fuck happened? I was just chilling. I was relaxing. I was having a good time playing the game. And then, boom, everyone's impacted in somehow in some sort of negative line after this. That's just kind of what happens. And people, I guess, don't realize it. You're kind of right. And you can't really meet the people in person to kind of understand that. I think, by the way, to that point, I've heard from behind the scenes and from Rin behind the staff or some people behind the staff that I've literally heard people are like, they're like, I want to punch this guy in the face.
Yeah.
Like I'm going to see him. I'm going to punch him in the face. Yeah. I imagine you get the same thing probably, right?
Yes. Yes. People either love me or hate me. There's zero middle ground there. No, you're right. And to me, because people, I've heard that line for myself as well. That's mind blowing to me. Because like, I could never like say or like actually do something like that to another human being. Like, I feel like people don't realize, at least like, again, personally, like my whole character is just a troll. Like, it's not meant to be taken seriously. And again, this kind of ties back to point one, where it's like, I think I need to be more aware of the influence that that might have down the line towards others, and learning to accept that it's not just about your perspective of yourself, but how the world views you too, and how that might affect other people is tough. It is hard. And like, even now, I feel like I have to walk a very fine line of what's okay, what's not. And you know, it's tough. It's tough, but I don't want to get stalked in the face at a con. I'm just trying to meet people and be nice. Like, people see me at IRL. They're like, yo, you were like very different from what I thought you'd be like. And I'm like, welcome to my entire life. Yep. This is, I've been like that since I was a kid. I don't know what to tell you, but you know, I'm sure you get it too.
Yeah, that's like the people that say like, oh, you lost a lot of weight. And it's just like, I just spent the past couple of years losing weight. What do you mean, bro? You just saw me after a year. Of course I lost some weight. It's there like that situation, I suppose.
On the grind. Well,
I wanted to ask you too, Samito. I mean, obviously you've been playing Overwatch for a while now. Now, are you back in GM? Are you back into the highest ranks in Overwatch currently?
I was like rank 30 earlier. Yeah, I climbed back in the depths.
Okay.
That was a tough week, man. That was a tough week. Oh my
Was it a
goodness.
Downfall, just constant losses over and over again?
I mean, I had Reinhardt's charging in the river in Rialto. Like, literally just, it was like every other game. And then, like, priority passes just come out. The season was ending in 5 days. And it was weekend ranked. It was just a perfect storm of, like, the worst things possible. And I just indulged in it. I became the mud that week. And oh my God, it was brutal. Do not do that ever. It's not worth it, man. No. I'm telling you. Save your sanity.
I've already heard weekend ranked is always a terrible decision anyways.
It's never been a good one.
No, it's never been good. But on that note, I mean, now you're ranked top 30. Have you ever thought about trying to play I mean, I know you said this in previous years. Have you ever thought about trying to professionally play Overwatch and get into the Overwatch League?
No chance. It's just not. Well, so the main reason I played in Contenders, like, to be honest, like, playing like esports professionally was never like on my main to-do list, which kind of surprises a lot of people considering like how vocal and passionate I can get about the game. They're like, well, you take it really seriously. Like, why don't you want to do it? Like, I always wanted to do YouTube or game design itself. I like playing professionally was just like, it just kind of fell in my lap, I guess, because like I was a streamer. I wanted credibility. I was like, how can I grow my stream? People care a lot more what you have to say if you have the credibility in life, where it's just truth. You know, it is what it is there. So I was like, I'm going to play Contenders and try to make Contenders and do okay, just for that credibility and to grow my stream, my brand, or whatever, and whatever happens, happens. You know what I mean? Like, this is just, I'm going to consider this a time investment. That was my motivation. Ultimately, it was the main reason why I decided to step back, because I knew that there was no way I could compete with people who have their hearts and minds set and are staking everything on playing pro. And like, my heart wasn't completely in it, because it wasn't what I wanted to do with my life. And even then, I'm not that gifted. I'm not going to be a Sinatra. I'm not going to be a dog man. I'm not going to be a, you name it, right? Yeah. Yeah, just not built different enough, I guess. You never know. Come on, man. Don't sell yourself short. We know how this goes.
Well, bro, I was the same way. That's the only reason I say that, is because I was the same way pretty much out of high school. Like, pretty much, like, I grew up, I'm sure you're a similar boat, where I grew up, I was watching all these YouTubers. I was watching, especially in the Minecraft era, I was watching, you know, people become big, like Captain Sparkles and shit like that, or whatever. My favorite YouTuber is not necessarily him, but like some other guys, like Uber Hackstronova and stuff like that. And then when I was 18, I was like, okay, I kind of want to kind of become a name for myself, like you said, get some credibility, become somebody that's more known, kind of join this social sphere. And that was kind of like where I was like, okay, this is where I want to take my career. So I was like, what's the fastest way to do that? And you're right. Playing professional is kind of like the fastest. It's not necessarily like I don't want to say it's the easiest because it's still pretty fucking hard. But at the same time, it's like that was kind of the easiest path to progressing into the social sphere and kind of making something else, because that was kind of the whole thing the whole time. Like, even during my last year, season of Overwatch, I was like, you know, kind of debating if this was really what I wanted to do, because playing professional, like you said, it's not exactly something that's in everybody's cards. It's not exactly something everybody wants to do. When you look at Violet and you play against him in Rake, this kid plays like 14 hours a day of just for Overwatch, just for Overwatch League's entertainment, right? He's not even, like, he's just focusing entirely on Overwatch, where some people like us are just like, okay, we're looking for other career paths. We're looking for other things that we would, you know, rather do, right?
Yeah, and you're nail on the head. Same for me. I grew up watching those YouTubers as well, and it's like, the 14 hours a day on the game, I couldn't do it. There's no chance. I knew I wasn't good enough to do it. Maybe I had the potential, but it just, you know, it's not there. Like, I personally just don't think I would have been good enough. And I am way too, like, ADD to just only do one thing. Like, I just, I can't. Like, I love having options. I love exploring new things. And just, there's just something about the start of a journey that, you know, you're at square zero. Like, you got nothing in front of you. And it's just the idea. And I want to live my life pursuing that idea. New ideas, new things. Like, I want to expand my horizons, and like the thrill of chasing that down and making it happen. I, you know, it really made me realize that it's not necessarily about the finish line. It's about the journey, you know, an old saying like that. And I don't know why I've started to think like that in my life, but it's just changed a lot, man.
Yeah. I mean, that's a good saying. I mean, I would clap right now if I could, Samito, but that I mean, that's true. I think it's a part of growing up, kind of. Like, yeah. I think when you're a kid and when you're younger, you're like, oh, I want to be an adult. Oh, I want to just be a famous Minecraft YouTuber or something like that. And then you grow up and you're like, okay, you know, it's like there's different career paths besides than just the one I was focused on as a kid. But on top of that, it's like, you're right. It's just the journey. It's doing something. It's being on the grind. It's having that fun motivation every day to kind of get up and start working on something else. And that's kind of what you've been doing, right? You've been playing some other games and stuff like that. We've recently just talked about a lot of Warzone cheating. Now, I know this is a little bit of a different topic because you've been personally into Warzone. I almost dropped my microphone. You've personally been into Warzone for a while. How bad is it over there? How bad is the cheating in Warzone currently?
It comes in waves. It comes in waves. It's... It can really know because of how they do SBMM. SBMM is not real, but let's say hypothetically SBMM was
real. What is that? Can you say what that is?
It's like ranked. You know how people complain about like, it's something matchmaking rate. It's basically MMR. It's hidden MMR where they'll check your score per minute in your KD and put you, they want players of similar skill levels playing together, even though it's not a ranked mode. Mm-hmm. And that's a whole other beast to tackle. We won't open that can of worms. But a lot of like the higher end lobbies, because they do that, end up seeing a lot of cheaters, and like it was really bad in the foul meta. Like, I have shadow plays of me getting sniped through three walls and getting insta down and getting killed, and I'm just like, are you kidding me, dude? Holy like shit. Turning the corner, the DMR just do, and I'm just like insta dead to a cheater who I can't even see on my screen. It gets annoying, but honestly, it's been better towards the latter half of 2020 than it was in the earlier to summer of 2020. I don't know what it was. Maybe a big patch came out. Maybe an anti-cheat came out. But I haven't been seeing too many recently. Thank God. Whew.
Yeah, I think it was in September when they had that. But it's kind of interesting because people are still complaining. It's interesting. Yeah, as Tolberica puts it, you meant skill-based matchmaking, SBMM is what it is?
Yep.
I think. And then like overall, recently in tournaments and shit like that, like Twitch Rivals, they've had... Okay, there's like a Kefri of the Warzone. I don't know if you know Tommy. Have you seen any of the Kefri clips? There's Kefri of Warzone. This guy like goes out of his way. Now, he doesn't seem like a bad guy. He doesn't seem like a bad lad, but this guy like goes out of his way to kind of call people cheaters and stuff like that. And so far, he seems to be 2-on-2. There was a guy called Peace. Yeah, I think it's Peace Setter, Peace something. I don't know, Pace Setter? That's what it is, Pace Setter, sorry. And then a recent guy called, if I can find it real quick, a recent guy... It's probably bad to give them out their names or whatever. Metzi, I think it was, that was actually banned live during a Twitch Rivals tournament. So it seems like it's becoming even more and more prevalent recently, at least in Warzone, than ever, which is kind of interesting. But because considering Warzone's been like a top game for a while, did you know actually that the mobile version, just a quick fact for you, mobile version of Warzone, I think was actually, or like the mobile version of Call of Duty was one of the top selling games of like all time, basically. It's fucking crazy.
People don't realize how big mobile gaming in general is on the big come up. It's some of the most viewed streams, especially. It's just not as popular in NA, in China, European speaking, oh my God, Spanish speaking countries, Oceanic, like it is enormous out there. But, you know, a question for you as well, like, do you think that's a gaming thing in general, or do you think it's specifically to Warzone, like cheating in tournaments and online play is becoming, you know, it's, I guess with gaming becoming more serious, I guess there's going to be more cheats.
Yeah, I think you're right. Like, at least recently in the past couple of days, in the past weeks, and even since our show started, like, we've constantly talked pretty much every other day about cheaters. Like, it's like there's always something about cheaters in the news. And I guess it's like, you're right, maybe gaming becoming more prevalent, more like news. And then I've even tried cheating in the past, but I like never got away with it pretty much, like back in the day. Have you ever cheated, Samito? Have you actually ever cheated?
I've had hacked clients in Minecraft, but I haven't hacked in PvP.
Okay.
Actually, so, on a faction server, I used X-Ray when I was 14 years old.
Oh my God, you cheated in Minecraft.
I cheated in Minecraft. That destroys
all credibility. You're going to have to get a fucking goddamn, a person to say you're correct. You didn't actually
cheat. I've never cheated in like a tournament setting or anything, though. That's sick. I'm too competitive. I want to let a kid know that I'm better than him from my own skill, or just I wouldn't feel satisfied from it.
What do you think about all the, just to go back on, I know you don't care about Minecraft too much these days, only because it's like you moved on to Overwatch and... Yeah. So what's your opinion, I guess, because, I mean, when you look at Minecraft's history, it was like, okay, first of all, there's all these people having fun and stuff like that, and then it becomes more serious with you and Dante and a couple of the other guys going into PvP and stuff like that, and now it's kind of made a revamp with speedrunning. It's kind of interesting to see Minecraft as like a game progress. Like, why did you never get into speedrunning instead of why getting into PvP and stuff like that? Is it just something that was never big at the time?
But yeah, speedrunning wasn't that big at the time, and the big trend was Minecraft Hunger Games to start. It was the MCSG, and then it went to UHC and build UHC, and there was all that. And it was PvP was just a thing, and it just felt so satisfying. I was always more of a player versus player kind of guy, so that was just more up my alley. And then in terms of speedrunning, I liked survival, but it was never something that – or speedruns, I guess. It was just never something I was into. I love PvP games and just the other aspect of just – right time, right place wasn't there for me.
Yeah. Well, yeah, and recently, I mean, like, we've seen it, not PvP come back at all, really, but at the same time, it's like these players, like you said, you came over from Minecraft, you came over to Overwatch, and then now, obviously, you've moved your channel over to YouTube, and this is a little bit of a different transition a little bit, but why'd you move over from Twitch to YouTube? I was just curious.
It's to quote Einstein, right? Gives me a diamond block. That's funny. Facts. I love me some diamonds. But the definition of insanity is trying the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. My stream wasn't growing on Twitch in the Overwatch scene. There were too many well-established, talented players that, you know, had trump cards, right? Like, what separated them from the rest of the crowd? And like, at the end of the day, like, my content and who I was at the time just wasn't enough to really gather the traction. So I was more familiar with YouTube and Twitch because I've been uploading Minecraft YouTube videos. It made no sense to me that despite YouTube being a bigger platform in terms of watch time, user base, everything for gaming, how is it that there are zero Overwatch streams that gain viewership? Because obviously the demand is there. People are watching Overwatch YouTube videos. How is it that there's not a single live streamer? So I was like, okay, I'm going to try this and try something different. I've got nothing to lose. Because when I signed my Twitch partnership contract in 2016, the rules were different. So the only thing that you couldn't do was stream to two platforms at the same time. So it was, I can stream on YouTube and maintain my Twitch partnership, because when I signed my contract, the rules were different. I don't have any of the modern benefits on Twitch that a lot of the more exclusive partners get, I guess, like the revenue splits, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, I still have options. So I moved and I started doing what got a lot of viewership, because it's not about the streamer. It's about the consumer. You want to reach out to people. You're making content for the consumer. It's not about me. It's about them. So I did an unranked GM, or a bronze GM. And I streamed it, and within 2 days, I was at 300 concurrent viewers, because I learned how to make my thumbnails, and people wanted to see a bronze GM, and I used that, and I used those videos to slowly gain traction and get recommended and stuff, and it was an uphill battle or uphill climb ever since then, really.
Did you throw to get to bronze? Is that what you're saying?
I actually didn't. Believe it or not, I still got banned when I hit Masters, and this is before they were banning people for it. I had 7 leavers. And I was just like, I'll just leave the game. Like, whatever, like what's going to happen. I think there was one night, you either picked Mercy or you had Leavers, and granted, obviously it was pretty scummy, so I don't do that shit anymore. I don't think anybody, sorry, I don't know if I can swear, my bad. But
no, you can cuss, it's fine. Shit. Yeah, it doesn't matter, dude. Who cares?
That's all, I didn't want we're to not,
no, we're not going after the baby audience. We have mature adults here.
Okay. I feel that. Just want to make sure, my bad. But
So you were leaving games, basically?
No, like, I didn't leave games.
Or
like,
somebody else
left the game, and it happened like 7 times out of my 10 matches. Oh. So I was just like, I mean, I'm allowed to leave. Like, I guess I will. And it kept happening. And I actually had the footage of it all happening too. And so when I made my video about like, frag so hard it got banned, like, I was like, I have the footage. Like, I'll respect Blizzard's decision, obviously, about the ban. But, like, yeah. I literally had 7 Leavers in 10 games. And no one believed me. And I had the footage too. And I was like, like, listen, say what you want about Bronze GMs and, like, picking Mercy in some of these games. I didn't pick Mercy in all of them. I think I played Hog one game. Or a couple games, and then I think I would do dumb challenges just to try to entertain myself because I would get so bored. It was so boring doing that. Like that's a big misconception about unranked GMs. People are like, pro players do it to boost their egos. Like, you think we care? Like, it gets viewership. That's why people do it. But you know, it is what it is on that one.
Yeah, it's pretty because it doesn't really challenge you. I mean, it's like the people that say, like, when you do, like, if you're doing a simple puzzle with just 4 pieces, it's going to be boring, of course. You got to kind of make it a little bit more complex and just play at a high level to have fun. Because at least when you're going through Platinum Diamond, like, that's just an utter trut. Like, you're treading through fucking muddy, you know,
muddy water.
That's just it's just absolutely disgusting. It's just not fun.
Yeah, I hate plats. Death to all plats.
But fuck plats and fuck tank players, right? I mean, recently I did a video recently on tank players people got they were not happy with. And I know you like to make a lot of rants on Twitter and stuff like that about patch changes and stuff like that. What's your take on like the current patch and the current meta? Because a lot of people are very much so like fuck Zen, fuck Echo currently. Are you on that same train or do you think that tank players deserve all that comes to them?
Echo definitely is overtuned. I think it's safe to say. I don't think she was as overtuned when Rush was meta, but if Poke is ever meta, it's just she's clearly too good. Like, so I think the nerfs are good for her. I think that the game is at its best when the original heroes like Lucio, Rein, Zarya are picked. And I think that that's what we need to have happen when Overwatch 2 comes out. And I think we need to keep taking the game in that direction because I wish more people would separate their personal feelings about characters and then look at the health of the game and the decision-making, how you get rewarded and stuff like that. I think, honestly, I'm not sure how Rein is going to come back, but I'm definitely on the nerf Echo and nerf Zen and nerf Poke. I think the game's at its best when Rush is standard and more heroes are viable. You can still play Poke into Rush on a lot more maps than you can play Rush into Poke meta. And it's just more fun. There's more chess of the game where, you know, like you rotate here. Like it's everything's important. I think you'll appreciate this as someone who played at a high level back in the old days of Overwatch where mechanics, cooldown management, team play, rotation. Like everyone could make a play. Everyone can make a play. And I feel like it's way more limited for how the game – I just don't think it's as smooth, if that makes sense. I can't explain
it. Oh, yeah, no. Yeah, right now it's very much so like, okay, you're playing, you know – High skill floor characters, but low skill ceiling characters, and that's kind of where it's at. And then you also said, I mean, we've talked about this in the past where you're like, okay, Blizzard, hire me as a balancer. But it's like, at the same time, they're trying to balance for, like, we have to realize, you know, they're trying to balance for, like, the casuals, obviously, and they're trying to balance, you know, based on which heroes are popular, obviously, like you said, you kind of distance yourself from that same scenario where it seems like Blizzard kind of doesn't. Like, they just kind of balance for casuals and the pros kind of come second and the competitive scene kind of comes second, right?
Well, I don't even know if that's what it is anymore because do you remember when they said that they were going to – I'm done trying to understand what direction they're trying to take the game. I think they've got a wheel of fortune and they're spinning that thing in a circle and God knows where it's going to land. But because like you can't really balance the game for casuals because the margin for error is so high at the level of play. How you implement things won't have a direct effect as often. And well, at high level play, the most minor changes can have major impact because the margin for error is so small, meaning the actual values of the game become way more important as to how it affects how the game is played. And Dude, I honestly, I don't know. I don't even know what to tell you. I think that
you don't know what the fuck they're doing.
I don't. And again, that's not me saying they've done a bad job this year. I'm not. That's not me saying I don't know what they're doing. It's so bad. That's me saying like some of the things are good, some are bad. But like I don't quite understand the direction we are trying to bring this product. All I do know is it's concerning that it doesn't feel like the original game. And if Overwatch 2 does not feel like the original game, where it felt open, options were there to make plays, and there weren't do-it-all characters that replaced the original cast of Doomfist to Echo to Genji, right? Sigma to Reinhardt, you know, Baptiste to Ana in a lot of ways, and what's another? Brig to Mercy and Brig to every support in the category. So I don't know, man. I'm a little concerned. I think they learned from October.
Is it because they're focusing like more on Overwatch 2, you think? Because recently, I think we got a tweet before this started where apparently this company called Vicarious Visions merged into Blizzard. And VV was apparently fully dedicating to Blizzard titles. So they're considering that these people are kind of focusing entirely on Overwatch 2, apparently. So, like, according to these rumors, like, they're hard focusing on Overwatch 2. Do you think that's the reason that these balance changes have been kind of, not necessarily poor, but you think that they're not, like, they're kind of out of touch with it?
I think a lot of them have been poor since October. I think everything past October should have just gotten scrapped. The Blizzard needs to understand sunk costs. If it was well received, and people were not quiet about it, by the way. Every content creator and pro player that we know, every single one of them directly told Jeff Kaplan how good, myself included, how good the game was. There's no way they didn't know, right? And I saw creators that hadn't spoke in years get riled up directly with feedback. And I was all for it, dude. I dropped an 1,100 word essay I was really heated. I was like,
and they're like, nope.
No, they listened to it. Like, the conception that Blizzard doesn't listen, I think, is wrong. It's do they act on it? That's what matters at the end of the day. So it's their game. They can do what they want. But is this company focused on Overwatch 2? I hope so. And I hope that's the reason patches have been bad. I don't think it takes a lot to make good patches personally. I think if you talk to the right people in the community, they can do it at no cost for you. But I think that the most important thing for Overwatch 2 that in terms of new content is going to be that format change. Overwatch needs to expand on the format. That's not just PvP. The PvE is going to be big. I have a couple ideas for Battle Royale spinoffs as well as other. Bro, I mean, they should do it. It's dumb that they don't. Like we have the best game engine for a shooter, the cleanest game engine to ever come out in the history of gaming. I will stand and I will die on that hill. Right, we have done it better than anyone else. The Blizzard design team, when it comes to game engines and cosmetics, are the best in the world, and I will challenge anyone on that. If you give them options to attract bigger, broader horizons of consumers, they will follow up. It's going to help. The reality is Overwatch League 2 is completely throttled by the lack of incentive of Blizzard to reach out and deliver on consumer interest. And if you look at the consumer interest over time, which is Google Trends, for example, where you see how much Overwatch is being searched up, it's been a constant downhill since launch. Fortnite has had multiple spikes up past its peak from launch. Minecraft has had multiple spikes past its peak on launch. What did they do differently? They actually implemented things outside of the box. And that will make or break Overwatch's long-term success. How committed is Activision Blizzard to making that happen? We'll see. PvE is a good start, though.
It's a good start, but it's like, at the same time, I mean, Blizzard's not really been known to kind of go outside the box. I mean, not Blizzard. Blizzard's been known to go outside the box, but it's more Activision that doesn't. And that's what people are saying is that, like, right now with the Activision to Blizzard kind of, like, the old Blizzard going away and the new Blizzard Activision coming forward, it's kind of like, okay, this company just sticks to tradition. You know what I'm saying? Like, they release the same Call of Duty every year. They release the same Overwatch now, I guess, potentially. From what we played at BlizzCon, it was kind of like the same game.
It was slightly different format, but it was the same game.
It was slightly different format, and then potentially with weapons and stuff like that. That change is cool. I hope that gets them into PvP. But I think, like, with World of Warcraft, people have been saying they're kind of releasing the same thing every year. And it kind of is turning into this more franchise model that necessarily isn't, like you said, looking at the consumers and stuff like that. Mm. But I do actually want to touch on that Battle Royale format. You actually think that'd be a good idea? Because yes. Like people, when I always brought it up, people were like, oh, you're fucking stupid. How would that work?
And I'm let, like, let me tell you like this.
How would, oh yeah?
Anyone who tells you that you're stupid for asking Blizzard to implement the highest demand consumer product on the market needs to take their head out of their fucking ass and never have such a take again. If they tell you you're dumb for going to the company and saying, yo, we should make the product that has the highest demand of all time, and they call you stupid, laugh them out the room. No way, man. They can do
it's
it.
It's just tough.
They can do it better than anyone else. It's not easy, exactly.
I agree.
But if Blizzard delivers on anything, it is on launch products that blow people's mind. In my opinion. True. When's the last time they had a failed IP? Maybe Heroes of the Storm, but whatever. Okay, that's a bad example. But
well, it's like you're bringing up a good point because at least when Overwatch came out, like, let's be real, like, even at the time of its release, these hero-based shooters were not really popular. I mean, you had Team Fortress 2, but whatever, right. That died off years ago, mm-hmm. right? Yeah. So they kind of brought back a dead genre, right? Mm-hmm. They kind of did bring back a dead genre. So imagine if they did, like, even if this company pulled what's Smite's company? Shit, who made Smite and Paladins and stuff?
Hi-Rez.
Hi-Rez, thank you. Hi-Rez has been doing this to a shitty degree. They've been fucking copying Battle Royales. They've been copying MOBAs. They copy everything to a shitty degree. And their games still get popularized. They still get a following. And it's like, imagine if Blizzard did this. And nowadays, we're not really in like a copycat system, I want to say. Like, you still have to make things by yourself. Mm-hmm. But the fact is, if you can create a high-quality thing, like Blizzard said, like you said, why not make a Battle Royale? I mean, we would probably need to talk about like the specific game mechanics and stuff like that. I think at least what they could do in Overwatch 2 is implement that idea with like the different abilities and stuff, right? Mm-hmm. It's like different character abilities, I think, in Overwatch 2.
I think
if they brought that to PvP, the skill tree, if they brought that to PvP, that'd be fucking sick. Kind of similar to maybe like a runes page. Yeah.
Yeah.
They could do that.
I mean, anything different, anything outside the box. That's the thing. If I asked you, why do you think Minecraft is the most successful game of all time? In terms of sales, everything, like, I think it is safe to say that Minecraft is the most successful game ever created. Why do you think that is, if you had to guess?
Because it's such like a sandbox. They literally have so much support and they have so much like accessibility and mods, right?
You can do anything. They didn't limit themselves to one format. They opened it up to the community, and that's what we need to do with Workshop. We need a map editor. If we did these things, there is no game, you know, on this planet that plays like a smooth Pixar film, that has beautiful graphics, easy to see enemies, and great character designs, right? Like, we are number one, in my opinion, at all of these things. It's just the ideas to diversify are not there. The best thing that can happen to Overwatch League is if Overwatch made a BR and didn't even have it interact with the league. Because what it does is it gets consumers in the door. And you say that consumer comes in the door, somebody that wouldn't have played Overwatch otherwise, right? Let's say you only get 30% of them to watch Overwatch League, but you make a game that gets 10 plus million players. Just let's say that they make a BR, which it would do, because everyone would try an Overwatch BR. We know it would be good enough to be top-tier market. That's 100%. Still 3 million more people around the planet, and at least in North America or wherever it may be, that would be interested in Overwatch League and maybe say, oh, I'll check this out. You build an ecosystem. You diversify. You get more consumers in your door. That is the model that the gaming industry has adapted to since Fortnite revolutionized it. Why are we still behind? That's what I have to ask, and I think Overwatch 2 will be a turning point.
Yeah, I think they'll probably answer that soon, but I guess it's like, to play devil's advocate a little bit here, it's like, from what I've heard from at least developers for the game, they're like, this game is a pile of duct tape, like, rolled together. That's what they're like, they mess up one thing and the entire game falls apart, apparently. Like, it's like crazy how jumbled the coding is behind Overwatch for how good of a game it is. It's like, I guess from that perspective, it would probably require a shit ton of dev hours. Like you said, they create such a great game that it's like, okay, there's probably a lot of work behind it, right?
Yep.
In order to create something that big.
Yeah, no,
I hope they do.
Absolutely, man. You're right on that. And we shouldn't sound like, and that's not the point of people at home. We're not being like, oh, this is easy, they can do it a day, right? But this 3 years down the line is something that should come out. I have probably like 3 or 4 documents tucked away that I'm saving for a rainy day that just highlight different game types that Blizzard should expand Overwatch to help it succeed. And it would take years of development, but are we going to have Overwatch 3 7 years down the line? Because, you know, we have a franchise league that we need to last for, you know, like an MLB sports league or an NFL, you name it, right? And, this is what it's going to take, in my opinion. But maybe I'm wrong, you know, who knows?
I mean, maybe you are, but I think, yeah, if they reach out to you, they can get those documents. I have one more question for you, by the way, Samito, for this weekend. Just before we let you go. Basically, the Kanazaka tournament's happening this weekend, right? What are you doing for? Are you doing anything? Are you going to go and play in the tournament? Are you casting it? Are you watching it?
I'm going to be watching it. I was talked about to cast it and potentially play with the team. I just have way too much on my plate right now to do it. I'm currently... Okay, I guess this is kind of like this week I kind of announced it, like I'm starting up a company and I'm making sure that, don't worry, I'll hook you up. You'll get free product. Don't worry, man.
Hey, this, my guy. When I got a product, I got you too. Definitely not the type of product you're thinking though. You know what I'm saying? Different type of product. Not legal product, legal product.
Yeah. We'll figure it out. We'll do a trade. I propose a trade, we'll old fashioned style. But I'm working with the legalities behind that. Making sure the product and everything's gonna be good, because I know it's gonna be. I think it might be the next big trend in gaming once I get it going, because I think gamers everywhere are gonna want it. So I gotta get all that done, and then I'm behind on videos, and I have Mayhem stuff to do. I have a bad habit of biting off more than I can chew, and I need to stop doing that.
Well, thanks for coming on our show. I appreciate you biting off more than you can chew in this situation. Hey, dude. For I hope you. It goes, so you're announcing it this weekend?
No. I'm just doing a lot of back end work on it this weekend.
Oh, okay. Do you have like an idea when your announcement, or is it like probably like a month from now or something like that?
Next month. It'll definitely be next month.
Oh. Well, shit. We'll be on the lookout, dude. I appreciate you coming to me, though, man. I appreciate you saying anything for me. That means a lot, dude. Anything for you, too. If you need anything, you got to hit me up. I'll help you out as well. So thank you, Amito, dude. Or Samito. What the fuck?
Ash is my nickname. People call me that. So
you're Amito? Right.
Amito, yeah. Some of my IRL friends call me Amito. See you, bud.
From now on. See you, Amito. See you later, bud. Love you, bro. All right. Dude, Samito's awesome. Fucking Samito's great.
Holy shit. That's high energy.
Yeah, Samito's a high energy YouTuber, man. He's a great dude. Great channel. I recommend you check him out. He's also here pretty much weekdays, week daily. He streams on YouTube. He's one of the biggest Overwatch streamers on YouTube right now. There's a lot of great, like you said, there's a lot of great Overwatch content on YouTube. A lot of challenges that people do. I noticed there's like a YouTuber that does challenges. He's pretty sick. Pretty cool to see, but great dude. Speaking about great dudes and awesome interviews, we have a pre-recorded message/interview with Super Matthew DeLisi pretty much directly right now. Just a little bit, we'll intro it in. But basically earlier today at like 11 a.m., we interviewed Super, and this is the first time it's being shown. I think he's streaming right now, but this is the first time the actual interview with Super is being shown. We did it earlier. I asked him some important questions. We had a voice call. We had some viewer calls in, which was awesome to see. And this has been another segment to our last one, and then we'll end it off there. So if Daniel gets that running, we're going to play off the Super VOD for you guys, and we'll continue this here stream another day, boys, on this Friday, this Fuck It Friday, boys. Hopefully we can get that running immediately. And our second guest today is a two-time Overwatch League champion, a sub-22-minute speedrunner in Minecraft, placing him, I think, within the top 100, if I'm correct, and some say his forehead is the size of Toledo. Super Matthew DeLisi!
Let's go, Super!
Yeah, let's go.
Howdy there. How we doing?
Howdy, man. What's going on? Totally live, not pre-recorded at all. How you doing, man?
No, sir. I'm doing pretty good, actually. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thanks for coming on, dude. Is this early for you? Is this when you're usually waking up, or are you on a D-gen schedule?
Actually, I woke up like, what was it, 40? Well, I got out of bed like 40 minutes ago, maybe. So I think my hair's still a little wet. Nice. I don't know if you can see. Yeah, you can definitely see it. It's still a little wet. Took a shower, so. Bro,
when was the last time you got a haircut?
That's a good question.
You don't know?
Maybe like... I think it was maybe right after I came home from finals. So like, what was
Holy
that?
Holy shit!
4 months ago, maybe.
Yeah, so yeah. You haven't got a haircut since the off season, basically.
Yeah, it's been a while.
Holy shit! Well, speaking of which, I mean, you've been playing Overwatch now for what, like five years now, 4 years or whatever.
Whenever it came out, yeah, basically, just been a while. Well,
And you've been playing Overwatch League now. You won the obviously Overwatch League two times in a row now. I mean, like, why are you still playing pro? What's your reason behind it? Because, I mean, obviously you have a stream you could fall back on at any time. And it's like now you're still playing pro after all this time. What's the purpose of still playing pro after winning Overwatch League twice for you?
Addiction.
Addiction?
I don't know. I mean, it's kind of weird, but like I feel like a lot of people wouldn't get it. But, like, I don't know. I really like competing. Like, that's just a big thing of mine. And, you know, there are... Okay, I mean, I've told this story before, kind of. Well, not even, like, a story, but, like, I've said this before where, like, it was during last season of Overwatch League, right before the final, the grand finals. And people were talking about, like, oh, Jester's performance in the playoffs as Roadhog. And everyone was talking about how, like, he was the better hog between, like, all the other hogs that were playing in the finals. And, like,
yeah.
I can't really explain it, but, like, reading that and, like, seeing all that stuff that people were saying, like, I made it, like, a mission that, like, there's no chance I would let any other hog, like, outperform me. And then, like, while I was thinking about that, I was thinking, like, oh, what if he's thinking, like, the same things that I'm thinking? And I put myself in, like, a perpetual cycle of, like, never letting him have the opportunity to want it or, like, to be able to... do more than I can. And I can't really explain it. It's just
well, you're trying to like suppress his fucking ego somehow.
I guess
through, like, psychological warfare.
Yeah, with myself, honestly. Like, it was just something I can't, I don't know. I was just so committed to not letting myself get, you know, embarrassed or outplayed, and I don't think I did. I think I played better. I, you know, it depends who you ask. We played different comps, and then a lot of people don't really understand the intricacies between the two, but, like, I could get into it, but it's just, like, too much. So, like, I think I played better, but, you know.
Well, you, like, I guess really that composition, the Roadhog composition you're talking about, by the way, for people wondering, basically in the playoffs, the whole comp and the whole meta basically changed. I mean, it was already kind of pre-existing, right? Like, I mean, Justice was running it before in NA playoffs as well, but it only really became meta once you guys went to Korea. And that's kind of interesting, like, the whole change between, like, how fast did the meta change from, like, the playoffs in NA and then when you went to Korea for the top four? How fast did that transition happen?
Yeah, I mean, so they played a lot of, like, Roadhog Zarya, Justice did. And then we went to Korea, and then, I mean, a lot of teams started running, like, Sigma Roadhog. Some teams ran, like, Ball Sigma on some maps too, and then we basically just started seeing like what worked where, and Zarya Hog just got dumpstered like no matter where you went, so it was just like really hard to make that work. So then the main comp became Sigma Hog, so
yeah. And then I guess like after that, I mean, Sigma's now nerfed as well, and that's good. I know a lot of people were hating on a recent tank player video I did. What do you think that, okay, so I know, like, tank players is a while, like, this game's kind of transitioned, obviously, like, it's gone through multiple phases, through GOATs, through whatever, and I think a lot of people have been, at least, like, to be honest, loving tank players in terms of, like, personality and stuff like that, and then also in the Overwatch League, but I know recently with the tank changes, it's been pretty rough. I mean, for you, like, playing Overwatch now, how do you like the tank and the balance changes that have happened to tanks in the current situation in Overwatch?
I don't know. I feel like, I don't know if it's a hot take. I feel like tanks are almost like a necessary evil, if you will, like in Overwatch. Like, I feel like to an extent, tanks have to be able to like suppress like other roles and smother them, because tanks are like, because if you don't, then you get like, you know, like widows that are uncontested across the map. You get like pharaohs that run free. So I feel like to an extent, you kind of need tanks to be able to hold their own and do pretty oppressive things, because if you don't, you kind of get situations where you have now where it's like you get the Discord and then like Echo, and then like tanks just get completely obliterated and it becomes like you just like die in like 1 second. It's like, okay, well, unlucky, I guess. Go next.
Is it not your fault when people play Reinhardt, though? Okay, like, I'm saying, like, people, like, without Lucio. Like, there's been people in ranked that, like, they're like, oh, look at this, guys. I got deleted on Reinhardt when I'm on Zen, Anna, or whatever.
Right.
Like, is that your fault at that point?
I mean, even with Lucio, Rein kind of has a tough time sometimes, I feel
he's
like.
Just dookie.
I mean, he's not, I don't know. I don't think he's in the worst spot, honestly, like, right now. But, like, if they have, if like, if you're trying to like close the gap against like Zen Echo, and then like, oh, there's like Zen Echo alone, honestly, is just so much spam on Orion. It's so hard to close the gap.
So you're saying it's because like Zenyatta's OP and stuff like that, or like Echo and Zen, the combo specifically?
Well, yeah, because I mean, like, if you have a Discord on you, and then Echo right clicks you with, and she hits all of her sticky bombs, it's like 270 damage. It's like, and it's a 6 second cooldown. It's like basically a pulse bomb on a cooldown. It's like, it's so hard.
Yeah. Yeah, and that, I guess people were like always curious, like why Echo was so, because she's gone through different changes that have kind of made her overpowered. And I guess like, since you've been playing Overwatch anyway since the beginning, like we've both been playing for so long, I mean, tanks kind of just kind of become, like you said, this necessary evil, which is kind of interesting because I think in the beginning of Overwatch, it was like tank players were just kind of showing up. Like, I think you were aware of that, right? In the very beginning, you know, you have like solid tank players, but when you watch back the old VODs, especially in the early days, like nobody was good. Like everybody was pretty bad, right?
No, yeah, I agree. Like tank players were like, I don't know, like no one even considered Winston as like a viable character. Everyone just played Ryan until like the World Cup when Miro played Winston. And then people were like, oh, maybe there's potential here for like, you know, like there's potential for a new character to emerge, and that's kind of what happened. And then people started playing Dive and stuff, and Ryan kind of shifted out of them. So I mean, yeah, it always went through like changes and stuff.
Yeah, and tanks now, I mean, obviously still not a great place, but I mean, like, okay, let's change a little bit of the topic here, okay, Super, for you.
Yeah, sure.
When I know, like, recently you've apparently placed in top 100 in Minecraft, okay? Yeah. This is a little bit of a different, this is not from Overwatch to Minecraft, but you're basically doing this part-time in what, you're 60, top 60 in the world or something
like that? It's like 65th right now, I think, something like that.
Is it still being verified right now?
Yeah, it's being verified, so I don't think it's on there, but it's, okay. If it were, I think it'd be like 65th or so.
So you're not going to need like a Harvard, like, you know, person, statistics person to take care of it,
I don't think
it, right?
I'll need an astrophysicist, I don't think that's going to be necessary.
Well, speaking of which, I was wondering, would you ever join the Dream SMP server? Would you ever join the crew?
That's a good question. I don't know. I mean, I'll be honest. I don't really know what goes on there. I'm pretty sure it's like mostly role play stuff. Like, I don't know, really role play. I think it's all right. Like, I think I would be like willing to try role play. I'll never get invited anyway, so it doesn't really matter. I don't know. Maybe I'll try it. Maybe sniff it out, see what's going on. You never know.
Give it a go.
Yeah.
Do you think you could actually have like a top 10 run in Minecraft while fucking playing professional Overwatch, or would you need to do it full time to actually get top 10?
I mean, a lot of it is like you need like a really good seed, so like you just need like pretty good luck. Yeah. But I think I have the skill to do it, but like getting the seed would take like a long time because you need to like grind out the runs until you finally get like that one run.
It's like just hours in.
Right. But maybe if I get lucky enough, I can get a good seed and then I'll be able to like crank out a really good run.
Well, how many hours in Minecraft do you have? Like, do you have like over thousands of hours in Minecraft just through like when before Overwatch and stuff like that?
So I played Minecraft a really long time. Let me think. I played Minecraft before I played TF2 actually, which is what I played before Overwatch.
Oh, wow.
And I used to play on like a factions PvP server way back then. So like I'm like familiar with like mechanics and stuff, but like there's a lot of stuff like, because I haven't played Minecraft in a long time. They added like so much new stuff to the game. Like I didn't even know what I was like I didn't know what like a bastion was. I didn't know what like all this like barter. Like there's so much different stuff that you had to like learn about.
Yeah, the meta.
Yeah, and I mean, like I was still familiar with like the mechanics and stuff. So it's not like it took me like that long to learn, but it's just you know, get back in the groove of things.
Well, you mentioned Team Fortress 2, and I was curious. Do you miss Team Fortress 2 at all? Like, was that your favorite game of all time? Like, in terms of like competitive nature, when we look at TF2 and you look at Overwatch, they're kind of they're entirely two different games. I know people like to compare them and stuff like that, but I mean, Team Fortress 2, you had multiple like roles, right? Obviously, that there was no hero lock, correct? Do you miss Team Fortress 2 at all, or like compare it to Overwatch?
Yeah. The main competitive format of TF2 was like it was called sixes, so six versus six. And it was mainly two scout, two soldier, one demo, and one medic. Because there were certain characters that you couldn't, certain classes that were locked. Like, you either had one of each character or one of each class or two.
Like, was that it was like the GA'd? Limit.
What do you mean, GA'd?
Like general agreements, like, okay, you can't play this, or, like, banned or whatever.
So, no. They had, like, the leagues had, like, rules. So, like, Soldier and Scout, you could only have two of each. And then Demo and Medic, you could only have one of each. And then there was other classes where you could have, like, one or two. But most people agreed that...
Why did they do that?
Because Demo and Medic, it's, like, really hard to, like, get those to be... Like, have more than one. Because it's, like, kind of...
Oh, okay.
You know, like, they're like, so oppressive otherwise.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
And then, like, Scout and Soldier are, like... I don't really know how it happened, but, like, that's just, you know, the way it eventually just became the norm.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, playing... I played Soldier, and just, like, rocket jumping as Soldier and, like, hitting air shots was, like, some of, like, the best, like, gaming experience.
Yeah, Pharah doesn't compare at all.
No, not even close. Like, Pharah is, like... If Pharah had, like, Soldier mechanics, like, the exact... If they had copy-pasted Soldier mechanics in the Overwatch, like, with, like, rocket jumping and then, like, you know, pogoing and then sliding up ramps and hitting, like, a huge... Like, it's... I can't even... Like, it's just so much fun. Like, you can't even...
Yeah.
It was probably, like, the most fun I had playing games, was, like, playing Soldier and like, rocket jumping and stuff.
Well, it's interesting because, like, we can kind of take that topic back to Overwatch, because in Overwatch, it seems like the characters that are best, like, I kind of compared Overwatch always to Dota. I don't know if you agree, where it's like the high skill cap characters are incredibly fun to play and they're, like, super exciting, but usually not meta because of the fact that, like, it's just too hard to make them, like, there's six people on the server, right? And if you have six people on the server, you'd rather play a lower skill cap comp, but that has a higher skill floor, right? Like, you'd rather play stuff that can... team synergy wise work out a lot easier, right?
Mm-hmm. I think a lot of the time, like, you kind of see stuff like that where people, like, they find comps that are easier to run rather than comps that are harder to run, because at the end of the day, like, teams don't have that much time to prepare for matches, so you don't want to, like, stress yourself out, figure out, like, what's the absolute, like, perfect comp, because people don't play perfectly. Like, people always make mistakes. Like, even the best players make mistakes. And you want to make it as easy as possible for yourself. And that's why I feel like... I mean, GOATS was the strongest comp, honestly, for a while. I believe that. But then I believe in Stage 2, Lucio got, like, a speed boost nerf, which, like, kind of opened the door for more DPS comps. But people didn't experiment with that until Stage 3 of Season 2, because GOATS was so much easier and so much, like... It was just so dominant still. Like, even if people ran DPS comps, like, you could still win against that. And, like, that just goes to show that people, like, the players and coaches don't have time to, like, really, like, grind out and, like, sit there for months and months to figure out, like, okay, this is going to be the best. Because by the time you even do figure that out, it's going to change anyway. So it's like, there's no point.
So I have a question for you then. In Season 2, before the Rolock in Stage 3, when Shanghai Dragons beat you guys in the stage, right? What do you think that... Because Rolock happened in Stage 4, right? Am I just
Stage 4.
So do you think that comp was actually meta, the one that Shanghai Dragons ran to beat GOATS, or do you think that GOATS might have still been the actual, like, best comp at the time?
Well, I think the thing is...
Or something.
We didn't really have that much practice against it. So, like, that, I think that was kind of one thing. I kind of think that if you did, like, grind out the GOATS comp, it probably could be the DPS comp. But I think at that point, you could argue that GOATS wasn't the only viable comp. Like, I think of, like, a fighting game tier list. Like, there's obviously characters that are more viable than others, but, like, you could still play those less viable characters if you perform them at, like, a, you know, higher level. And that's kind of how I feel like where the DPS comp was at. Like, it was really good. Like, it was good. But I think if you really, like, get the practice against it as GOATS, you could probably beat it.
Yeah, because you just need, like, better rotations, right? Better, like, strategies kind of moving up. Like, just kind of min-maxing, like said. Pretty much as, like, I think Daniel said, like, that what you're doing with your Minecraft runs and stuff like that. I had, like, kind of a team question for you, Super. Mm-hmm. So I know during the offseason, were you a free agent, or can you not, I don't remember if it was in the contracts.
I mean,
stuff
yeah,
like
my
that.
So my new contract, or my old contract expired going into this offseason.
Okay, so were you potentially looking at, like, other teams in Overwatch League, or only staying with Shock?
I mean, you know, business is business, right? You know, you gotta see what's where. But you know, I thought about my situation, and I just was like, you know, I think it's probably best for me if I just you know, because I mean, I've already got such an established, like, foundation here with Shock, and, like, I know everybody. I just feel like it was probably better for me if I did. I mean, I did have interest from other teams, I will say that, but you know, I just felt like shock was probably the best situation for me.
Imagine Super and Moth on Gladiators. No, I'm just, I don't know.
You never know. It could have. You never know. You never know. Maybe the team, maybe Shock blows up and then I get traded. You never know.
I doubt that'll happen with Krusty running the ship.
No,
I don't think so. I asked Moth about Krusty. I don't know how much you can actually give him on this information before we kind of go into viewer questions and stuff like that. What do you think that Krusty does like so differently compared to every other coach in Overwatch that makes him stand out? Because, I mean, you worked with Sephy before back in Shock in Season 1 and then obviously switched to Krusty after that. What does he do that kind of puts him on like another level and kind of makes him the greatest coach in Overwatch?
I mean, I feel like for one, like, he really doesn't, like, he doesn't really take shit. So, you kind of have to respect that. I feel like he does know the game pretty well. Like, especially compared to most other coaches. I feel like he just kind of has, like, a different, like, he's just above them. In terms of understanding the game. And I just feel like most, I feel like a lot of players, I mean, maybe this has changed nowadays, but like, especially back when like Overwatch League was like first starting, a lot of players had like egos and like they didn't really like trust coaches. And I feel like that's still kind of true to this day where like the players think they know more than coaches and they're like, oh, you know, like I don't need to listen to this guy. Like I'm here. He's not right. Like they don't really think that they need to listen. But I feel like Krusty has kind of garnered that respect from like everyone else in the league at this point. And I don't think that's something that many coaches can really say they have. Because he just kind of, he can kind of prove it at this point that he's, you know, capable of doing it and being listened to. And I still feel like there's players in the league that haven't broken past that like trusting phase with when it comes to like, oh, this coach, he doesn't know what he's like, you know, like just stop speaking. Like I know more. And they don't really, like, they kind of just, like, tune it out.
Yeah.
But I think Krusty's kind of different in that aspect.
Well, I mean, I guess, like, just because you can kind of see it because Stryker even left Boston with him to go to Shock, obviously. Right. And I think Stryker is probably one of the more, I don't want to necessarily hot-headed person, but I know that necessarily, like, I remember if you remember that scrim that we had just a while ago, and I think when we were getting, like, spawn camped by you guys on Oasis, if you remember. I don't know if we were scrimming or not. We were getting absolutely shit on for like three maps in a row in a scrim, basically. And then I think Stryker was like, good team, lol, in the chat. He like typed good team, lol.
Yeah, Stryker does a lot of that kind of stuff when it comes to Yeah.
Well, specifically after that, like, we had like a big internal fight after that, basically. We were like raging after that, or at least specifically I was. And then after that, we started fucking sweating our balls off, and then it was immediate trash talk in the chat, but like he's somehow, and I kind of want to touch on Stryker because people always mention how I don't know. Personally, I think Stryker is a bit underrated. I don't know what he's gotten these days, but I know like when, for example, we were also scrimming you guys on another map where Rascal was in, okay, and then you guys would lose, and then Ons and Tayo were in or whatever, then you lose. But then you'd have Stryker, and then he went in and he played Genji, and then he'd just be go balls to the wall, like hard aggression, kind of similar to like Sinatra to a degree, right? And I think like, I don't know, do you think that his aggression and his play style is a little bit underrated? And do you think that, like, Stryker is actually one of, like, the best players in the Overwatch League?
I mean, yeah, he is one of the best players in the Overwatch League. I think everyone on Shock is. I feel, some players on the team, I feel like I'm kind of part of that group, too, where, like, they take initiative and, like, tell people to, like, we always say, like, you know, don't play like a bitch, like just get it, you know, like get in there. And like, that's kind of how we do sometimes. And you know, sometimes I feel like there are players that have to, initiate that because like certain other players, like don't have like that, I guess like that mentality or like that leadership, I guess, to be able to say like, okay, let's go, like, let's stop, you know, stop playing passively or whatever. And then we got to start playing aggressively. And I think Stryker is one of those people that can take control like that. And really like lead the team in that kind of aggressive way.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't want to like give you guys any tips or anything like that. I mean, obviously you guys know, I mean, you have your guys' secrets and stuff like that. And we've never even won anything. I mean, all we have is beating you guys in that playoff matchup pretty much and just getting kind of lucky.
I mean, that was,
We have a question, I think, by the way, from a viewer. We got like a little bit of a voice call for you.
Yeah.
If Daniel set it up, because I think it has to do with Sinatra. So I don't know how long it's going to take to get set up. But is the voice of God here? Daniel, are you available?
I am available. We should be able to just run straight through the line for both of y'all. So let's see if this works.
Cool. All right.
Hi, my name is Jackson. I'm from New York, and I have a question for Super. First off, Super, big fan. You know, love watching you on the streams or on the Overwatch League stage. Question, what was it like playing with Sinatra in, like, the grand finals or just in general before he retired? Have a good day.
Oh, what was it like with Sinatra? Well, yeah, first of all, thanks for the compliment. Yeah,
appreciate it.
Yeah, it was very nice of you. Second, what was it like playing with Sinatra? I mean, Sinatra, he kind of had that same thing where he was just like, you know, like aggressive. He didn't want to play. He didn't want to play slow. He liked to get in there, but like he was smart about it and he knew when he had to do that and when he did have to pull back. You know, Sinatra was a good teammate, and I mean, I'm glad he's finding success, you know, in Valorant now. And I don't know. I mean, there were people that like were like really like mad about him, like when he like retired mid-season. But like, I don't know. I couldn't be mad at him because like I don't want him to like keep playing Overwatch, like especially if he was like miserable doing it and then miss his opportunity to play Valorant. Like I feel like that would have been just really like selfish of me to say like, oh no, like if I would have been pissed, like that's like selfish and like. Yeah. I don't think that's right. And so I'm glad that he did what was better for him and that he, you know, went to Valorant and he's having fun and he's doing well. So,
well, I kind of, that brings up the point. Cause I think myself and Moth were talking about this before, and I know this might be overrating Sinatra, but I think both me and him kind of agreed that Sinatra is in contention for one of the greatest players of like all time in Overwatch. And that kind of got a lot of flack. It was like, okay, is that actually the case considering, you know, Prophet's done so much, I guess, like you said, even the gesture point, like people will say gestures even is like the greatest of all time based off his track record with season one and whatever. And they kind of like to go off of that. Who's your greatest player of all time? And is it you? Do you think yourself you're the greatest player of all time or no?
Okay. I think in terms of, I mean, I think Sinatra had the greatest year definitely ever in Overwatch.
Oh, yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
The only thing he didn't do was win finals MVP, right? Because if he got that, then he would have won Overwatch League, stage one and stage two, or stage two. He would have won stage two, went to all three stage finals, won the World Cup, got World Cup MVP. And like he basically did everything there was to do except the finals MVP. So I think he's had the greatest year, definitely, ever. Greatest of all time. I mean, I've said this before. I think it's kind of hard to say because like there's no, I feel like it's hard to like discern one player that's like so far ahead of like everybody else in like their role. That you can make, like, you could say, like, they're definitively, like, because, like, Michael Jordan in his time, like, I always say Michael Jordan, because, like, he was, like, obviously, like, everyone said, like, oh, he was, like, the king, he was, like, a god, like, I think Larry Bird said, like, he's a god in, like, a basketball shoes or something like that.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Like, he was, like, so far ahead of everybody else, like, you couldn't even argue that he was, like, the best. But I think if I had to pick, I would probably say right now, Violet. I would probably say, because...
Yeah?
I think Violet is...
Yeah, you love Violet, yeah.
No, I think he's the best flex support in the game.
I think that's hard to disagree with.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Some people say Alarm. Some people always say, oh, his Ana's not that good. But, I mean, first of all, his Ana is good. Like, that's not... Like, people don't, like, people always say, like, oh, but he was benched in week one of season 3. Like, they don't... Like, he wasn't benched because his Ana was bad. Or, like, he didn't play Ana because it wasn't... Not because it was bad. It was just, like... There was, like... It was a communication thing. Like, that's why he didn't play against Dallas in week one, was because, like, Architect knew, like, how to, like, calm, like, you know, like, what he wanted to do better than Violet did at the time. And we didn't have time to fix it because the match, like, we literally decided the night before that, like, Architect was going to play. Like, we literally did one scrim with Architect. So, it's not like, it was just that one thing that we couldn't figure out. And then we just tried it with Architect and it worked and we didn't have time to fix it. So, it's like, okay, we'll just make that work, I guess. But, like, his Ana's not bad. And then I think his BAP and Zen are easily number one. People would argue, like, oh, maybe Alarm, maybe, you know, whoever, maybe Shu. But I think his Zen and Bap are number one easily.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I just think he's the best flex support, and he's really good.
Well, to put it from this perspective, as another flex support playing against them, I remember there was scrims where I would like, I'd be like, okay, because personally, I've always had issues with focus when I'm playing the game. Mm-hmm. So when I'm playing Baptiste and when I'm playing flex support, obviously you can't do that because you have to really maximize your kit. You have to really maximize your potential.
Yeah.
And then there was like a scrim. I think I was like, okay, Violet's fucking outperforming right now on Baptiste. So I was like, okay, this next round, I'm fucking trying my ass off. I'm going hard. And then I think like at the very end of the round, because obviously the stats show up in the top left, it was like Violet has 2,000 more damage. Violet has 2,000 more heals. Right. I'm like, well, fuck, this guy's on another level. And I think people kind of underrate, I guess, Shock in general. Because like we said, we talked about Striker before, and I don't even think Striker gets brought up in like the best DPS conversation. And then you think even Violet doesn't like always gets talked over from, like you said, like Alarm, like some of these other flex supports. Do you think Shock's being even underrated still after winning two championships?
No, I wouldn't say underrated. I can see your point about like people not saying like the best DPS is like Striker. Like people kind of don't really put him in that conversation. People always say like, oh, Fleta. People say Rascal. People say like, you know, a bunch Prophet. Of like, yeah, Prophet. But people never really say Striker as like the best DPS. People say he's like the best Tracer, but like he plays other stuff really well too. Like especially his Reaper is like really good, and like he plays other few here. Like I think his Sombra's good too. Like he plays a lot of stuff. And then Violet, I mean, he gets definitely more credibility, or like he gets more credit, I feel like, than Striker does. But I mean, yeah, Violet's just, I think he's really good. And I think it's personal, like playing with him and seeing like what he does to other teams like on a daily basis, like there's just no chance any flex support does what he does. Like, I'm sorry, it just doesn't happen. Like, because we scrim with him every day, and like, the way he just like does, like sometimes he just like casually gets like 3Ks. It's like, okay, like no big deal. Or like he'll go on like some, like he'll just do something stupid that doesn't make any sense. Making. Yeah, but like even like his mechanics, like he does something stupid that doesn't make any sense, and he'll get like a 3K. It's like what are you doing, dude? Like, doesn't even.
Do you think if you grinded as much as him, you could be as good as him at flex support? Or like not just you, but anybody in general? Or is it just he's a genetic mutant freak?
I don't know. I mean, he is built a little bit differently. It is kind of hard to say. but I mean, he also like puts in the hours too. Like he did, like sometimes like during the season, like he would do like 15 hour streams and then sleep for like an hour and then go to scrims the next day. Like, I don't know what he's doing, but you know, it is what it
he's
is.
Just
I guess.
Wired different.
Yeah.
He's just wired different. All right. I got one more question for you, Super, if you don't mind. I mean, let's see. Okay. Cause I this gotta be a good one. You talked about World Cup earlier. And I know World Cup has the potential of happening this year, potentially not. Mm-hmm. What do you think the World Cup team for Team USA this year would be if there was one again this year?
Yeah, I mean, at this point, I feel like it's kind of off the table because, like, I feel like we would have heard something by now if World Cup was happening. But if it did, you know, I've said before that I don't really feel like playing again just because I didn't have, like, between season two and season three, like, I didn't have a break, really. Because we won season two, and then I had, like, 2 weeks, and then we started screaming for World Cup. And then after World Cup, we went on a boot camp in Korea. And then I went home for, like, a week and a half for Christmas, and then I went back to L.A. So it was, like, I didn't really have an off season. But if there was a World Cup, I feel like right off the bat, I would probably pick Space and Moth right off the back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then I would say Nero would probably be in there. I'd like to see Dante get a chance to play in the World Cup because he never played in the World Cup.
Oh, yeah.
So I'd probably have my DPS as Dante and Nero, which is kind of rough because you don't really have like a Widowmaker.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you'd need a specialist.
Yeah, you need like a hit scan specialist.
Bring Baby Bay back or something.
Yeah, bring Corey back. And then for flex support and main tank, I mean, I guess we'll put you on the team. Why not, Dogman, for flex
support? No. I'm fucking trash. I'm seriously trash. There's a couple, like, new players, I think, right, in the Overwatch League that are American? Are there? They're all underage is the problem. A lot of the really good flex support players are underage, I think.
I don't know. America. I mean... I'm trying to think, like, because I feel like flex support in Overwatch League is such a strong role, and like there's a lot of Korea flex supports that are like really good. I'm trying to think though, like who's in a I'm not sure who an American flex support is besides you, honestly.
Yeah, it's tough. There's not really anybody in that role right now. And there's a lot, like I said, there's a lot of underage kids, I think, that are really good. I think Mudkip's really good. Mm-hmm. There's a couple other ones, I think, in ranked and stuff like that that are grinders. But yeah, I don't think there's many. I mean, just America's a tough region for flex support. It just really is, unfortunately.
And then for main tank, since I said I wouldn't play, I guess I would probably pick Gator, I guess.
Oh, yeah.
Because I feel like Gator's not bad. I think he's pretty good. I feel like that team has some pretty good potential.
Yeah. Yeah, it probably does. I think it would be decent, but I think with the win over Korea in the previous years, I mean, obviously that was like kind of like everybody leaving on top because Sinatra's there, like you said, needed a break. I mean, have you even like taken a break since, you know, season one, I guess? Like you've kind of been on the hard grind.
Yeah, not really. I don't know if that's necessarily healthy. Maybe no. I should, but, you know, it is what it is, bro. I guess.
Yeah, I mean, it is what it is. I mean, if you want to get a break, I mean, coming after this year, then it'd probably be worth it. But that's literally like 4 years of just hard grindage. So there's actually one more question, by the way, Super, before you leave.
Yeah.
Because it just was recent news yesterday with Jake becoming like a player coach. Yeah. What do you think about that? What's your take on Jake becoming a coach/player for the Houston Outlaws again?
Yeah, I think that's kind of interesting. So he said he's a rostered player. So he takes up a player spot, but he's acting as a coach.
Right.
Which is interesting. I think you have to be kind of careful about that kind of stuff because I think you can maybe get some like weird dynamics there. Like one player having like more power than the others. But because like he is a rostered player, so like he could see playtime, but he says he's gonna be a coach. But like I think Jake is pretty mature overall, and I think he'd be fine like in this situation, but I think as a general rule, you have to be careful when you have like players that are also coaches because you can like, it can be like kind of a conflict of interest. You know what I mean? I think Jake would be fine with it. Like, I don't think Jake's going to have any problems with that sort of thing.
No. Yeah. He's a pretty mature dude. I mean, I think, and I even asked him, I was like, that'd be nice to see you start again. He's like, yeah, probably projectile roles is more his thing anyways. Mm-hmm. And then a lot of the players in Outlaws probably do need some coaching, especially some of their projectile players like Hydration and KSF could probably use a little bit more like comms and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But shit, thanks for coming on, Super Dude. I appreciate your time. I hope you have a good stream a little bit later. I guess it's going to be during this time. So, you know, I hope it's a good stream right now, bro.
maybe I'll take a break. Who knows?
Maybe. It'd be a good idea, probably. But yeah. We'll catch you later, Super. Thanks for coming on, dude.
Have a good one.
See you later.
Peace out.
Adios. All right, boys. That was fun. Super's a nice dude. Super's a great guy, actually. Even though in ranked, we've always had personal... You know, I think there were times where he called me a feeder a couple times, and listen, he'd probably be right, you know? Oh, my camera never switched, too. Fuck me, dude. Nice show. But, hey, thanks for coming, guys. This was this was pre-recorded before this whole thing. But, you know, the Dusttin Bowerman Show goes on. You know, we had to figure it out. We had to figure what's going on today, and we got it going. So I hope you guys have a good weekend. Catch you later next Monday.
All right. It's the end of week 3.
Yes, sir. You're on the grind. Thanks for coming, Super. Appreciate it, dude. We'll let you go. Are you going to go back to sleep or are you going to go stream?